All right, welcome to the Sae Bae cast, number 157 with Noobtype. Noobtype, how are we doing today?
Hello. Doing quite well.
I'm excited for that. I just had Saxophiller on the cast, and now we're having the back-to-back, like, go-to PvMer. So I'm really excited to talk, and I know you've been highly requested. Let's just, like, get a little bit of the history with how you popped up on the scene. Was that through Twitch, or were you already pretty, like, recognized?
I wasn't known anywhere, really. It was mainly, it all started because of ToA, really. So, my best friend, Sido, before this, at the time, I didn't have a Twitter or a YouTube, so I had, like, no social presence. And when I told him that I got 460 invoke completion, at the time, it was the highest invoke completion ever, then he tweeted that out for me.
What an awesome guy. So this is literally like week one, right? To do a 460 or week two or something around there?
It was before they released the fame kit. I forgot when that was. Actually, hold up. I think I have the dates here. August 31.
Okay. And ToA came out when? Do you know? It's like August 24th or something like that, right?
August 24th. Oh, so literally first week. Yeah.
Wow. That's so. And for those listening, I mean, I'm pretty sure this was the case. You'll correct me if I'm wrong, but weren't the invocations a little bit harder or something was different? What was that?
There was a lot of things actually. So, you know how you level 2 and level 4 bosses would alter the mechanic level of each boss. So that back then, mechanic level would alter at level 1 and 2. So you would have, like, 6 memory Akka at level 2, machine gun Zebak at level 2 as well.
Holy.
And the scaling, the HP scaling and defense and all that were also different too. They were doubled compared to how it is right now.
Holy. Really?
Wow. Yeah, that's ridiculous. And Shadow was still, like, really, 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 really bad.
Yeah. There.
It still had the 3x accuracies and 3x damage. So your max hit was like 67 with salts. It was crazy.
Oh my gosh. Wow. Yeah. Because I remember. So you did a 460 on.
Yes.
By the end of the week. And I remember when the Fang Kit, or before the Fang Kit was released, Port Gazar did a 500. Must have just been shortly after you. And that looked so stupid. Like, the amount of random glitches he had to perform just to get that done was just ridiculous. So when they actually did announce, and of course, changes were made to ToA, like, since that. But when they released the Fang Kit and it was 500, I was so, like, shocked. I was like, what are you doing? Like, this is crazy. Like, this is going to be basically, we're going to have to be like Port Gazard level. But obviously a lot of changes have been made, including, like, what you said, the shadow has been buffed and metas are formed basically. So.
Oh, another thing about the 500. So the 500 completion that me and Port did. Mm-hmm. So we did those, but we completed ours. Yeah. On the same day, but his was first. But we ran different methods. So the crazy thing he did in his run was the Zebak Venge Bomb. I was like, what the heck? I would never think of that. And that is such a big brain strat. that was really cool to see.
So it was possible to be completed a different way. You did it the traditional way, I'm imagining?
Yeah, so the way I did it, so it was kind of funny. It was kind of funny at the same time, because when people heard about my completion, they looked at my invo list. And at the time, this wasn't even meta. It was Yellow Karis with on a diet and dehydration on. Port's run, he had those off for tickets and healing for Venge Bombs. So when people saw that, when people saw my invocations, when people saw my 460 completion, people were congrats me in game and stuff. But when they saw my completion and my invo list, okay, they're like, okay, how did he do it? What kind of bugs did he exploit? I'm like, what? So what happened here? Well, how do you go from congrats to like interrogations?
Yeah. Yeah, it happens. Well, they're probably just confused that like if you know, just, you know, shortly before that you just popped off on the scene from somebody else, you know, from Sitto. It's like, you know, people are probably going to be suspect, but ultimately, and so had you been streaming this? Like, did you stream your 460? Did you stream your 500 at all?
I only streamed the VOD of it, but So at the time, I only had like, I only started like a month before, and I only have like 100 followers and stuff. Mm. But when I started getting known through Sitto, that's when people were like, where do you watch this guy and stuff? I didn't even planning on like streaming much, but a lot of people like wanted to see me play.
Yeah, and then that just and I mean your name became obviously like familiar after those achievements, and now it seems like you've been pretty consistent with streaming. It seems like you've been actually, I mean, for the past what, like year and a half now at this point, you've done some other crazy achievements on stream, and you've been doing like what I deem to be impossible, and you're just like grinding it on stream. It's just crazy. So let's rewind again. So after the 500, you decided to go for a 770. Can you just explain how that was even possible for those? For those that don't know, and maybe just a little bit more background around that time.
Yeah. So, the max invo possible in game right now, in main game, is 600 invocation. But back, there is a bug that became known where you can have literally all invocations of the same set activated. And having those on will actually increase the level as well as level scaling as well. So 770 is literally all the invocations on, including like all the time invos, all the death invos, and every single supply invo. But it would always count the last like invocation. So if hardcore is on, it would just count hardcore instead. But the levels from the other invocations of that set would also be counted in towards the level.
So for those wondering, like that would include like the monster's defense and HP, correct? Mm-hmm. So that would all scale proportionally to 770, but just not all the obviously all the time invocations wouldn't add up or subtract or whatever.
Okay. Yes. So I got the preset from someone because I actually wanted to do it. I knew like it was like having multiple invocations is bad because like I know people will like actually take advantage of that. So like I knew the risk that if I actually complete this, I'll possibly get banned.
So was it just purely just to do it, just to be like, just to have done the highest invocation, basically like the hardest challenge in the game at that time?
Yeah, pretty much that. Yeah.
Okay, so it was totally worth it. So how quickly afterward did you get banned? Did it require you to actually post the achievement in order to get banned, or like do you think you would have gotten banned regardless?
I think we would have gotten banned regardless. Hmm. But so I didn't know when they were going to do it, but I felt like there was going to be a ban wave because there were a lot of people abusing it. I think like 100 players got banned mm-hmm. for abusing it, including me, of course. And at the time, I didn't even tell anyone that I got the completion. I only told like some of my friends. Mm. And I think 2 days later, I ended up finishing my video. Then ended up releasing it.
Yeah, that was pretty crazy. People were just like, it was purely just humor. I mean, it was like, you know exactly what's going to happen, and yet you decide to do it anyway. So you got a 2-week ban, is that correct?
Yeah, so funny enough, when I first got the message, it said two or three days. Then literally someone PN'd me, saying, "Oh, did they increase your Did they up the amount of days on your ban? I'm like, wait, what? So I checked again, then it said 2 weeks. I'm like, what?
Oh, no way. My God. Was it just to like be standard with like everybody else kind of, or what?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, interesting. 'Cause it, yeah, that, I mean, it makes sense. They obviously couldn't have not banned you, but just because of all the drama that was going down, so I feel like they had to make it fair across the board. Yeah. Around that time, you know, people were just grinding it just for more purple chance, it seemed like. I think there was, more, obviously, like seven.
More purple chance and to get an easier, like, kit as well.
Oh, yeah, because like, the kits were already released.
Yeah, the kits were released, and you're able to, like, a 500 with, like, all of the hard invocations off. So you can do, like, Akka without any invocations and such.
Oh, that's a good point. That wasn't just for purples. There was also, I think this is debunked, but there was, like, some glitch where you could enter into the reward chamber one at a time or something and, like, log out or something. Something was going on with purple. What was that?
Yeah. So the, what people did was they had to do something with like re-rolling purples. So if they logged out in a way, the purple, if they had a white chest or whatever, they would like log out in a way. Then once they enter the chamber again, it pretty much re-rolls the chance of getting a purple.
That is crazy. So you would need to have at least done it in a duo, right? Because you need one person outside.
Because if one person, if it's only you, the instance is gone.
I heard like people had done that, but it was never like malicious, apparently. At least that's the last I heard about it a year ago or something, that like it was the case that was happening, and there were some instances of it, but it was like nobody did it nefariously. Like it was just kind of like accidental or something like that. Or maybe they did it once and they didn't abuse it. Do you know any more on that?
Not quite, but yeah, there would definitely be people who would take advantage of that.
Yeah, that was a crazy like month. I feel like that was all in the first month of TOA. A lot happened, and there was definitely a lot of drama just regarding the whole thing. But that makes a lot more sense why people were, because there were I believe three permanent bans on the invocation bug, at least what I'm trying to remember on that tweet.
It was there were three permanent bans. I think they like did multiple runs of that. That would be my guess.
Yeah. Well, it seemed like, at least according to, I'm just trying to think, because this was like a year and a half ago. I made a ramble on it talking about like Seven's perm ban, and there was like a couple others, but Seven was like the prominent name. But apparently, it was due to like him just repeatedly just running these as much as possible within the time frame that it would be.
That makes sense.
Yeah, interesting. And, you know, it kind of sucks because, like, ultimately in this game, there are things that are, you know, what, like, people could imagine it's bug abuse. Like, for example, when, I don't know if you remember when Cerberus could be, like, completely AFK'd. Like, you could stand on a corner of, like, Cerberus and just Tebow it, and it wouldn't do any attacks. And you could
literally I heard about that, so...
Yeah, so that is something where, and people were literally streaming it live on Twitch, like, hey, like, this is a new method, you know? So it's really hard sometimes to gauge if things are a new method or if they're just straight up bug abuse and you're going to get banned for it. It really feels kind of pick and choosy.
So I do have a hot take. So I think mechanic and bug abuse are the same exact thing. It's just people say bug abuse because it's a bad thing, but people say mechanic because it's a good thing, or they think it's a good thing for the game.
Yeah.
So in this case for Cerberus, so the boss would stall. Okay, so you said the boss would like not attack you at all.
I think it was something like that. It was like some sort of red X or something.
So if it's something like that, people would say bug abuse because like you pretty much like take out the challenge of the fight.
But it's,
if that makes sense.
I mean, it makes sense, but then you would just see another example, because at that time, I mean, all three of the main wilderness bosses were able to just be totally safe spotted and then remove all the mechanics from the boss and just hit it until it dies. but that was deemed fine. So when the Cerberus thing came out, it seemed like on that tier of bug abuse, we're like, maybe this is just going to be the case now where, you know, people exploited and found out about the wilderness safe spots. So why is this going to be any different? But, you know, it really is just a matter of whoever the J-mods are and whatever the community sort of deems as like fine that ends up going. So ultimately, just tracing it back to the like invocation bug, I do kind of feel bad for those that did get perm banned for it, because it's like, I don't know. It just feels like another case of this is something in the game that can be abused, but I don't know. There's always a little bit of like discrepancy. I don't know. It's hard to gauge. And as well, this is my personal take. This might be hot take, but I feel like when it's not being done by like just anyone, like Cerberus could be done by a lot of people, but like those high invocation like TOAs in the early days, not many people would have been able to do them regardless, because it's not like you're just getting a free raid. You would still have to do like a full ass raid, but it's just going to be slightly easier. So it feels like people really kind of like ganged up, sort of like, oh my gosh, like these guys are just abusing the purples, like just kind of like creating a narrative in their mind, like these guys are just totally abusing this for purples or whatever, and they need to be permed. But it's like, it's easy to shout that out when you had no real, I don't know, like you didn't even have the potential to abuse that almost, because this is just like out of your skill level, sort of. Like I just saw a bunch of noobs yelling and like, good, perm them, like grabbing the pitchforks and everything. So I don't know, it's just interesting. Yeah. Interesting. Okay, so let's talk a little bit after this now. So after like the TOA, after the 770s, what was your sort of mentality on TOA? Did you want to start like back, so after like the invocation bug was patched and everything, what was your kind of goals at that time? Was it to, I'm trying to remember the timeline, because TOA was out for so long without other new content. Awakened Bosses and everything came out like a year later.
Let's see. So I wanted to, this was an old challenge of mine. I wanted to do like a 1+7 600, but that project got scrapped. I only was able to do 1+2. So after the 770, I wanted to do like something crazy, really. So another challenge I did was doing a 600 without Karis. So doing that, but the importance of yellow Karis in a 600 raid is yellow Karis is your biggest source of sustain. And without that, it makes like sustaining like really, really iffy. So like now P1 Warden can deal like 75 damage, both orbs, and you can't really heal that if you don't have a Karis. Same with P2 Warden. Without a Karis, you're going to get obliterated by Warden itself. So the other alternative to that is to literally redemption every hit.
Is that chanceable? Like, is it possible for the Warden to hit over a 10 or over a 9, I should say?
With Quiet Prayers, his Warden's max hit is 15 with mage in range. I think it's max with melee is like a 10. So if I dropped below 15 HP, I would immediately proc redemption with Locate Orb. And that was my main source of healing.
I see.
that's how I also did my my 500 as well. Oh, another thing is, so the early 500s, during that week, potions were also bugged as well. So ambrosias no longer became ambrosias and adrenaline became a one dose on accident. So if you were ever to take double power from the spirit, you'd only have 2 adrenalines total.
Oh yeah.
During that week. So another thing is, when people saw my invocation list, they're wondering how I got through Zebak and Warden, because Zebak would destroy you with Quiet Prayers, and Warden, you'll need like three. People assumed you need like 3 doses of adrenaline, but I thought otherwise. And I literally redemptioned P1 and P2. Then I.
That is crazy. Yeah. So what are your thoughts on like ToA in general? Is that your favorite? Have you? Obviously, you've probably done all the raids, but I know you, and I feel like most people know you for all of your ToA feats. Is that your favorite raid?
Now it is, yeah. Because of my endeavors there, yeah. Before that, it was Chambers, and yeah. So, a long time ago, I played in Twisted League. This was the only challenge I've done before ToA. So I wanted to become the first person to do a Death SCM in Twisted League, but I got really unlucky on the whip. I was stuck at Abyssal Demons. Abyssal Demons for like 3 days, trying to get a whip.
Then, oh my god, unlucky.
Then I think on this the second day of me grinding the whip, Wilkes gets his whip in like 8 minutes at Abyssal Demons. I'm like, what? Then he sends the Colosseum on that same day. I'm like, no.
Oh, that is so like in a different reality, if you had gotten better RNG, you may have been the first.
Yeah.
Damn. Unlucky. Yeah, that's just pure RNG. That sucks. Yeah.
That was really the only challenge I've done and prior to ToA.
Okay. Interesting. So what, like, I'm just trying to imagine a type of player, because I put you in the classification of like Wooks and Port Gazard and all these giga gamers, unpredictable and just doing like just crazy stuff. What, like, is that just how you're built as a player? Like, you just want to keep pushing, or did this kind of develop over time? Like, because I'm imagining you didn't just, you know, start playing RuneScape and just all of a sudden are really, really good at the game. I'm imagining it took a lot of practice and a lot of like just playing the game for hours on end to get to a point where you want to push yourself harder. So what, explain like the journey behind getting to a point where you want to just push the limits of this game.
So my first like drive of doing that came from my very, very old clan. So I wanted to learn Chambers back in the day, because my clan leaders were the ones doing it, but they were also elitists as well, and they didn't want to teach me. So I thought, I'm gonna learn from someone else, then I'll become better than them at it.
Damn! So it was like a little. It was like a matter of like proving yourself, basically.
In a way, yeah, because yeah, they were also like toxic too. So
yeah.
Like, I had the mindset of just like, I want to prove these guys wrong and like so badly.
It works. It's a motivating factor, that's for sure.
And what do you call it? Shout out to chemistry for teaching me.
Oh, nice.
He taught me Chambers and Top.
Oh wow, what a throwback. Okay, so ToA's released in August of 2022, and then 2023 goes by, and all of a sudden there's talk of, you know, Desert Treasure 2 bosses coming out. And I was expecting when DT2 dropped in the summer of last year that they wouldn't release the Awakened bosses for several months, because I swear they just like talked about it a week before the release, basically like, hey, are you guys interested in this? And then I swear like a couple days after the release, it's like already in the game without any sort of like beta or any, like really no analytics based on what the difficulty should be. And yet they nailed it. I feel like they absolutely nailed those bosses. They're fair and they're challenging and they're like short and sweet. They're not like Inferno level length. So what are your like overall thoughts on the Awakened bosses in general, and then we'll start getting into some of the crazy stuff you've done with them.
Overall, I think they've done a really, really good job, because it made like most of the player bases even struggle, including me. The only critique I really have is Whisper. Whisper is like the most like tedious. No, the Weekend Whisper is the most tedious one to do because it's just so slow.
Mm-hmm.
World record is like 6 minutes. And 6 minutes is already like, it already sounds long enough.
Yeah. Now that one did feel, it's just long. It's like one, I would probably say it's the least enjoyable as well going for it. It's probably the easiest, I would imagine. I mean, I had a...
Yeah, so there's not much of a difference to Waking Whisper because literally there's nothing that alters you to like play differently, really. Mm-hmm. It just adds more pillars to solve, and it adds like more downtime for you to kill the ghost and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like there's really not much of a difference besides like if you take damage, you're pretty much bound to die, really.
Yeah, so, like, which it's still a difficult fight. Like it definitely took me like 10 plus attempts for that one, just simply because of stupidity, mainly because of the shield mechanic. For some reason, I just panicked and I would like try to take a 1 second look at the pillars and then just inevitably mess it up because there's five you have to do, and I didn't really know the strategy behind just looking quickly. But
if you compare these to the other three bosses, you definitely have to play differently. So Fardorvis, for example, you cannot camp the yak spawn, otherwise the spawn will actually damage you. So now you have to stand elsewhere, and there's also like one additional axe you have to worry about. Plus, there's also two heads during the enrage phase. So something like that, where you're forced to play differently.
Okay, so now let's talk about some of the crazy stuff. I remember a tweet that you put out that you had all the world record times of the Awakened bosses at once. That is nuts. Was it?
Oh, yeah.
What do you think was that? I mean, obviously, most people probably weren't grinding Awakened bosses after they got their Blood Torva, so there wasn't like a huge selection of players that were doing it. But still, that was an insane accomplishment.
Yeah, there weren't that many people really competing for it. And I was also like developing methods of my own, and just so happened to get it. I just so happened to get all of them. And I was like, hey, that's cool.
Oh, so you weren't even really pushing for it. You're just like, let's just randomly
get
it.
Let's just get it. Yeah. Cool. Then right now, I don't have like all four. I only have Duke Wreck right now.
Mm.
That's the only one that remains from that tweet. I think literally
after... Wow. It's remained since then.
Yeah. So wow. Literally after a day after I post that tweet, Whispering Wreck gets taken. Then I think someone beat my Vardorvis, but I took it again on that same day I tweeted it. And Leviathan, I don't think that one's broken until like a month later. But
even if the tweet only stood for a couple minutes, it's still ingrained, so that was pretty cool. The other thing that you ended up doing was, and I don't know if you were the first for this, you'll have to kind of explain the background of other players, but you had done all four bosses, and I think you've done this multiple times at this point, doing all four bosses, all four unique ones, with one inventory.
Oh yeah, so this came from Addy's challenge. So he had a challenge going on where for weekend bosses, so one of them was doing all four in one inventory. Where was the one who did it first. I did it myself much later because I was actually like really busy that month. And I only heard about it last minute. I'm like, oh no. then Addy offered me 100 mil for me to do it because like I missed out. I pretty much like missed out on the challenge. So in compensation, yeah, he offered me 100 mil to do it. Then.
Okay, so that was that one. Then I want to talk about probably the craziest thing I'd ever seen in my life, which was initially Port Gazar doing a 22 Awakened Leviathan in one inventory. That includes, most people saw this, but for those that may not have, that includes having all 22 orbs in his inventory for the kills and as like they go, and he can't pick up any drops. So... And that, I'm just like, what is happening? When I saw that, I literally was just like, what the literal fuck? Like, I thought the Awakened Leviathan was like you know, and this is before I had done it yet, so I just imagined this being like one of the hardest challenges in the game. Obviously, once it's solved, it really is a matter of just playing perfectly, but that's still insanely difficult. And then I swear it was like 1 or 2 days later, I don't know, you randomly post, just came out of nowhere and like, here, I'll just do 25. So 25 awakened Leviathan in one singular inventory. Didn't you only have like one Sanfu in your inventory?
Let me check.
I'm going to pull up that tweet as well on my end.
So I had purple sweets, Sanfu, and a rune pouch, and 25 orbs.
Oh my god. Okay.
That was also one of Addy's challenges that I was also like really late on. So like I ended up doing it like much, much later when I had the time.
Mm-hmm. What goes into, how many awakened completions had you had at that point before you decided to send 25 in a row?
Let's see. I have a video up on the side. Uh, 400.
Holy.
Yeah, I can link you the video. It's
okay
right here. I wasn't planning to do an edit for this because I want to go for the absolute max eventually. 25 isn't the limit. 27 is.
No way. So that would, what is that exactly? Is that just the rune pouch?
Yeah.
Oh my god. So that really requires, so what was the whole thing with sweets? Was there like a rule that you set yourself that like,
so the rule was Karate's challenge was, mm-hmm, you can only use 25 sweets per orb. And yeah. So in the video I had pretty much 25 for each orb, but I didn't end up using all of it.
So do you think, yeah.
So now 27 is literally just rune pouch and 27 orbs.
And would you be so allowed now to like wait and let your HP regen, or would you set yourself your own limit on that?
I wouldn't wait for HP. I'd just wait for rune energy. That one's more important than HP.
Yeah, okay, that would be important. And then whatever HP you gain, like the little bit of HP you gain.
Yep.
So, like, is that, are you intimidated by, like, is that something that you would see yourself being able to do in, like, one or two attempts? Or do you think that this would push you?
I was actually attempting the other day.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I can show you where I died.
Okay, let's see it. Do you want me to leak it to everyone, too?
Probably not.
Okay, well, I'll just take a glance.
Let me find it real quick.
Yeah, you're good. I just have this Awakened Leviathan on the side. But 3 hours and 13 minutes of just pure concentration on this 25 Awakened Leviathans. Oh, wait, is this unlisted?
It's unlisted, but there's a public playlist I have that shows my unlisted runs, so
okay,
it's public, but marked as unlisted. But
wow,
I was, let's see, how many morbs am I missing? Let's see, 3. This was the 16th kill that I died on.
Oh no. Okay. So what's going through your head at this point? You seem like a pretty calm person. Like, are you just like, do you just accept defeat and move on, or were you pretty much like, I hate this? do this again.
I just say like, oops.
Bro, I mean, I guess to be fair, anybody that would like have like a rage problems or just get really pissed off at things probably wouldn't be doing these kind of insane challenges anyway. But oh my God, like what exactly happened during this run that went wrong? Was it just like a
So
misclick or?
yeah, it was a misclick. So over the east wall, I accidentally clicked over that wall, so path me into that little corridor. Then I ended up taking chip damage. Because
I see.
if you're not near the Pathfinder, you take chip damage through prayer. But
Ooh.
if you're under the Pathfinder, you're as long as you're using the correct prayers, you'll take absolutely zero damage from Leviathan. That one misclick killed me. I'm like, no.
Okay, can you explain the air staff and the shield and then just the lack of rune pouch in general?
Oh
What's
yeah,
going
so
on here?
this is another setup I'm using.
Okay.
So apparently with my first setup, I would have to alt I have to I would have to average 4 prayer points per kill if I want to use up my prayer only. So to make things easier, I would having air staff and shield would allow me to sneak in prayer. So now I can average 12 prayer points per kill rather than 4. And on average, I use 8 prayer points per kill.
Okay, but how are you bringing 27 orbs in the first, or is this like, because you have to have a T-bow, right? So how are you equipping, or I'm lost as to how you could have 27 or was this a 27 orb run?
27 orb run, yeah. So so my inventory consists of a T-bow and 27 orbs. And then the air staff and shield I equip.
But what about your rune pouch
Oh,
or
the
the
runes? So
runes? Yeah.
the runes come from the Ring of Shadows.
Oh,
So
holy
now
shit.
air staff and Ring of Shadows allows me to shadow barrage. And whenever I shadow barrage, you have to equip that air staff no matter what.
Oh my
Yeah,
God. This is nuts, dude.
it
Okay, that's crazy, dude. That is some crazy shit. Okay, and just I want to also just put this into perspective in case people are, maybe thinking, okay, well, if you can just do an Awaken Leviathan, you can just do it multiple times. But you got to keep in mind, like what he just said, you have to preserve your prayer points. You can only use a maximum of 8 prayer on average per kill in this. And that
Oh, so
is.
12 prayer points. 12 prayer points, but I average 8.
Okay, that is crazy. That is so nuts. I
Only
mean,
that, you have to maintain your run energy because you have no access to sweets.
oh my God, dude, that is nuts. That's some crazy. So, wait, when do you think? I mean, I guess I shouldn't really ask you this, but I'm just curious. Like, do you think you'll be able to get it done pretty soon? Is that the plan?
uh,
Or are you just sending it whenever you feel like it, kind of?
Whenever I have the time, I'm sending it.
And I guess you only, I mean, unless you fail early, you only really get one attempt per day. I mean, it's not like you would want to be grinding this all day anyway. I mean, it already is an all day thing anyway, but holy crap, dude. That is.
I think I estimated the time for me it takes to complete this. It take the run will be like 4 hours and around 30 minutes for to get to completion.
I am just so mind blown by that. I swear to God, like it just we're at the point where like we just see I feel like people are getting to the point where we just see these kind of things and we're like, wow, like another one of these. Okay, move on with my day. But like we gotta I am still just in disbelief about how this stuff is even possible. So like
Yes.
seriously, like huge props to like the accomplishments you've done. These are just insane. Like absolutely insane.
I was planning to make a video for an edited video of the 25, but when I thought like I can go like further, now then I'll make a video on that one instead.
You're crazy. Okay, so wait, let me hear about this. Would it be possible? Well, okay, this is actually just stupid, so don't actually, like, don't take me seriously on this. But I was just thinking, what if, you know, you're trying to do a 27 run, but now you're going to try to do, like, something even higher, but you have to get the orbs from the kills themselves. So you have to, like, keep running it until you get good enough RNG where, like, you start picking up additional orbs that land on the ground. Don't actually do that. Don't listen to me. I'm going crazy.
If I was about to do that, I can, like, take in, like, a much better gear, especially, like, a rune pouch, so I don't have to equip the staff every time.
Yeah, but it would still be, like, heavily reliant on RNG. Oh, yeah. Speaking of this, what are your thoughts on the, I mean, obviously, Awakened bosses for you seem to be just repeatable. It seems like you've forked out several bills, I'm imagining, on orbs.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so I guess I'm just asking, like, what are your thoughts on allowing these to be, like, more freely accessed to the public?
A lot of people have, like, their solutions to fixing, like, replayability, but mm-hmm. I do think, like, we should use orbs, but also have, like, some sort of refund system if you get a kill.
What would you think of that? So, like, what's your idea for it?
My idea was have a chance of refunding your orb on that same kill you did it.
Okay, just a chance? So what would the chance be? Like 50-50? Probably
like 1 in 4.
Okay. Because most people are just thinking, you know, you should... And again, if this was the case, you could do some disgusting feats with this kind of system. But a lot of people have just been... If you get the kill, you should just get an orb guaranteed. And that would, you know, it would still stabilize the... Well, actually, no. I mean, the orbs would get cheaper because ultimately people would just get super, super good at awakened versions and just be able to do them freely, basically, at that point. But, yeah.
I'm not sure how. So you're an iron. Mm-hmm. Are orbs actually, like, really hard for you to get?
No, I mean, if you're not, well, what I've seen Iron Men do is, like, if they want to get Blood Torva, for example, they'll just do main practice on main accounts and then they'll send their limited orbs. But, like, I had, you know, 50 plus and I was able to get my Blood Torva with that amount. And I still haven't completed the bosses. I'm still missing Pets and I'm still missing Virtus. So ultimately, like, you do have a pretty damn long window of getting orbs. I'm imagining you're probably going to get around like 200 orbs by the time you've completed all the pets on average or something like that. And then with 200, that seems to be pretty reasonable. And if it takes longer than that, I mean, by the time you've done all those normal variants, you're going to be so good at them. Like, and the thing is, the Awakened bosses translate pretty well over to the Awakened. Like, if you get good enough at Whisper, normal Whisper, those skills lead over to the Awakened version, like 100%. So I don't know. I don't think it's that big of an issue to answer your question. Yeah, did you have anything to add on that?
Yeah, I thought it was, like, really hard for Irons to get it.
I mean, I would be pretty jaded if I didn't just say up front, like, I play this game a lot, so, like, I'm not, I'm not on that top tier echelon of PvMers by any means, but I've definitely played this game enough to just be able to maybe do some things a little bit easier than the average player. I play this game every day, so. Yeah. But you're right. I mean, well, here's the thing. Even if you were guaranteed an orb at the end of a kill, like, that's not going to make the Blood Torva grind any easier for an Iron Man, because you have to actually do the kills in order to get them. So, I don't know. I think the way it is right now is fine. I'm pretty actually indifferent to having a change in how you kill the Awakened variants. But the people I've heard, the general feeling is that it just sucks that these Awakened bosses are so fun, but there's a price to be paid to enjoy that fun. So
one thing I also wish they did was also increase the pet chance in Awakened.
Yes.
So that way, if they implemented that, orb prices would be, like, reasonable, and you'll have like a reason to actually do Awakened. Because right now it's only 3 times unique, and that doesn't like feel right.
It doesn't. The boss time itself is over 3 times as long. So it's like you're literally getting worse uniques.
Yeah.
Is the pet rate increased?
No. So,
wow. That's nuts.
What I think is they should really increase the pet rate in Awaken so that, yeah, the prices of orbs will be reasonable and probably be even more. And that also gives reason, also gives a reason for players to replay the Awakened bosses as well. So
right now
it's just a one and done, and those bosses are really fun. It's just that, yeah, there's, as you said, there's a price to pay.
Okay, to do those. That's a genius idea. I hadn't even considered that. So what would your thought be on like the rate increase for the pet?
Probably the same rate, like 3 times unique plus pet.
Okay, so really only 3, because I'm thinking in my head, I'm thinking like do it like 10x or something.
I think 3 is fine, because
okay,
I've done a bunch of them myself, and I think it's a waste of potential for not having them have some sort of incentive for replayability.
Yeah, well, the only reason I'm saying higher than 3% is because it's, if you only made it 3 times, then I mean, it's still just as long to get the pet. I was thinking, you know, make it significant enough to really incentivize the pet hunters, especially to go for the Awakened bosses. Maybe the uniques could still say 3x or something, but like the pet itself, if you were to make it like 5 or 10, I'm even saying like 10x. Like if Awakened Leviathan was all of a sudden 1 and 250 for the Awakened, I mean, bro, there would be people just sending Awakened attempts nonstop. The orbs would really skyrocket briefly. I mean, they would shoot up.
They wouldn't be like 1.8 right now.
Yeah,
it would be like much higher.
That would, I don't know. I think I'm almost thinking like really pump up the numbers, maybe 10x, but I don't know. Maybe I would need to hear like some reasons against it. Oh, it's actually the orbs are 1.9 right now. They've risen.
Ooh. Oh. Nice.
So, not nice for you. You're trying to send those in. Well, I don't know. You probably don't care about money. What are your thoughts on GP in general? You probably don't even care. Yeah.
GP? I have more than enough. So,
you probably
made able to afford these orbs.
Yeah. How much money did you make at ToA? Do you have any idea?
ToA? So, purples alone, I've made like 10 bill, I think.
Sheesh.
Oh, let me check. Oh, 12 bill.
12
in
bill.
In purple and unique Simone. Boosting, yeah. I've made like 60 mil? 60 bill?
Holy shit, dude. 6D, right? Like 6-0?
Yeah, 6-0.
Oh my god, dude. And then how much do you think you've spent on orbs total? Do you have any idea?
Orbs? 9 bill.
9 bill on orbs.
And Jesus. I also bought a sword axe very early, and it was the second winning game. That one costed me 5 bill.
Jesus Christ. And was that when the broken axe was happening? I don't really remember the bug. It was hitting like 200s or something.
It was a day after the hotfix. Yes, so yeah, I ended up buying an axe. Ended up buying the second one in game for 5 bill. People were offering 4 bill, then I really wanted to test it out. Then like stream it on various pieces of content. Then like I overbid them.
Are you like a mercher by any means? I mean, you do have a ton of capital. So, well, one of the reasons I ask is because there was like, it probably is still happening, the price manipulation in Third Age, but I was just wondering if you participated in that at all.
No. I think like a few months after I got into like boosting, I was able to afford all the Third Age, and all the Third Age at the time, was priced at 5 bill minus pickaxe. So I bought the whole collection for pretty much cheap, and now they're like much, much more expensive.
Yeah, were you able to sell it at its peak, or do you still are you still holding on to it?
I've always wanted like a 3H collection, and I've never planned to sell it.
Okay, very cool. Yeah, because though I mean, okay, this is ridiculous. Somebody in my stream, I'm assuming they're not lying, but apparently the pickaxe shot up to like 15 bill or something like that. Something ridiculous. Do you have any
Yes,
data on that?
it shot up. At one point, it shot up around to like 25.
Oh my God.
And I have four of them. So,
The fuck? But they're not 25 bill anymore.
yeah, they've dropped. If I recall correctly, someone dumped a bunch of their pickaxes that they bought for cheaper.
Okay.
Then I think that caused a crash in the market.
Holy. So you had four pickaxes when they were worth 25
I
bill.
still have four of them, but
Okay, yeah,
yeah,
but you
we're.
but even when they were 25 bill. And did you like think to sell them, or were you just like, "No, nah, I'm going to keep them?"
I'm just gonna keep them.
Wow.
I don't plan to sell them.
That is so
I bought
nuts.
them for. I bought my pickaxes for cheap too, so like if anything, if I sold one, it'll only be profit.
That's so nuts. Okay, so how many pickaxes do you think are even in the game? Do you have any idea? 'Cause
Like,
I
hey.
remember. Yeah, go for it. Sorry, I was just gonna say
Probably.
like right beforehand, like a couple years ago, or maybe like 1 or 2 years ago, I saw some data on like there was only like 40 third age druidic sets in the entire game based on like some clue data. But that's
Druidic
probably increased.
sets.
Yeah, druidic sets, so like probably a
So
couple hundred.
probably close to 100 pickaxes would be my guess, but I'm pretty sure I'm like far off.
That is so nuts to think that an item is worth 25 bill at one point. And then there's probably like those random players that are not on social media and have no idea what the prices are and just like go and like, "Oh, I'll just sell it for 2 bill on the GE because I just pulled one, luckily, you know?" So there's pro I can't even imagine how many players there are that do have max cash stacks that are just like have an offer in for a third age, for just basically like a third age pickaxe in the druidic and stuff. They just pray that one day some noob will pull a pickaxe and just sell it there.
I saw the other day someone actually sold their pickaxe to the GE. Then I
Oh
was like, oh no, they could have had four times that value.
Oh, that
Or
is.
four or five times that value. Yeah, right now the pickaxes are like hovering around like 9 bill. That's how much they've crashed. But I do think they're gonna go up again.
That's crazy. Do you think like third age is like the Bitcoin of OSRS, where like you really should just hold it indefinitely because they are just so rare?
I think so, yeah. Because I remember a few months ago, all the third age items went up, and I assume that merchants like bought them out of the G and stuff.
I wonder if they're gonna come out with like more third age pieces, like some unique ones. I don't know how cloggers would feel about that if they just started releasing more, but I think it would be kind of cool to get like some third age boots or something, some other
I
stuff.
think they should add more,
Yeah, that's what I think too.
because it's been a while since they've last released a clue update or a clue expansion. I'm pretty sure they have like ideas, from like the past couple of years that they didn't have like a chance to release them. So I think more third age. I'm not saying it's because I'm like witching game. More cosmetics will be really nice.
That's what I think too. I feel like we shouldn't cater to those like super end game cloggers that would just get butthurt over anything being added to the game at this point. So, what were some other ToA feats that we may have missed at the beginning?
I'm not sure if many people know this because I didn't really post it, but Do you notice yourself? I was the first one to think it.
Yeah, I wasn't unaware of who were the first people to do that. But you were the first.
So, I actually have a screenshot here. So I didn't know my rune light this whole time was actually keeping track of my collection log screenshots. Let me show you. So okay. this was 3 hours after the update.
Oh my god. September 8th. Holy shit. So what, you had already done, I mean, a 460 at this point, and this is after some of the changes were made. So you were probably pretty confident with being able to pull 500, right?
This was before they did all the shadow buffs and stuff.
Mm.
And all, yeah. And they also lowered the scaling of each room and stuff. So
that is crazy.
So the first week of Fang Kits, mine, I don't think anyone else has completed the first day, if I recall correctly. The second one took like 3 days to obtain.
Jesus.
Man, mine was 3 hours after the update.
So were you just like wandering around the like Grand Exchange? I guess it's not really like on the same, I mean, it is on the same level of difficulty, at least then, of getting an Infernal Cape. I just wonder, were you like flexing it? Or
I was flexing it to someone. Let me show you.
Okay.
So I actually found Dodie doing ToA.
Oh, shit.
And I showed him. Shit. He included it in his video. Let me try to find it.
That is so cool. Yeah, I mean, that was, and I'm assuming, this was soloed and everything, right? Was it harder at that time, do you imagine, like before all these changes were made, to have done a solo or to have done like more duo? Or do you think people just weren't too inexperienced to have it help?
It was a little bit of both. So they also made another change that made Fang Kits much easier to get after this week. So you were able to add in like a free 40 points to a 500, because the first week of Fang Kits, they still had silent prayers. I'm not sure if you remember that. The silent prayers invocation.
And what was that again?
It was just like quiet prayers. Instead of 10%, it was 25%.
Oh, Jesus,
in dude. Prayer.
Oh, that is nuts. Okay. That's huge. That's a huge change. Huge buff.
So during that week, I saw one of the craziest 500 completions. So I'm not sure if you know who Jay Rays is.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
So he did a 500 for his Fang Kit, but in a really, really different way I didn't really expect. So he did one with silent quiet prayers plus silent prayers on. So that also meant you're getting hit 30 through prayer.
Oh my god, how is that even possible?
He he took a bunch of brews to his envy. Then he also did the Venge Bomb method at Zebek.
Okay, wow. So just sweet some brews.
Yeah, so when I saw his run, he was just getting hit 20s, 30s through prayer, and I was like, oh my god.
Oh my god, that's nuts.
I'm just like, I've never seen anyone take so much damage like this before. And he was still able to complete it. Watching his run was like one of the most anxiety runs, most anxiety-inducing runs I've ever seen. I'm just like, what the heck? That was even crazier than mine, because I was like really anxious. On my run, I was really anxious about P2, because like you have to redemption once you get to a certain threshold. But his was just like, everything was just railing him.
That is so funny. Okay, you know what I also want to talk about is just some of the tech that was discovered in early TOA. So obviously, Butterfly Method came out with the help of other people, and Sactor Pillar kind of like helped. I was talking to him last week about that, and that came out, and then Red X Baba was a thing. and there's just a bunch of really cool tech that kind of came out around then. So what did you help, I guess, discover back then, or things that ended up becoming meta?
So not many people know this, but me and a friend of mine, we came up with the melee prison, the one we do to trap the melee.
Oh, yeah, from Kefri.
Yeah. Me and him came up with that method. Then locating redemption proccing at P1 Warden, that came from Sax. So his original idea was to locate orb and stall, but when I tested it out, all you needed to do was just locate orb instead.
Mm.
Then Red X, I'm pretty sure like a lot of people figured that out on their own, including me. Mine was a really different method. I was like walking through Baba from like one end to another end.
Mm.
It was really weird. But
what was the, so now I want to ask about, like, well, you mentioned Kefri, and then I remember watching your just crazy runs where you're doing like some spellbook swap stall.
Oh, like, so
what is happening there?
Oh, that's so I got that idea from Sax. So what that does is if you spellbook swap or do some sort of character stall, you're during near the timing of where the dung pushes you back, that dung will only go to where your character was, if that makes sense, rather than like filling that entire column.
Mm-hmm.
So there's, you can like dung only one tile at times too.
And that helps in what scales? Because I mean, for those listening, I mean, you're doing some just stupid scales with Kefri. Is it essential to do that in some scales?
So in a solo, if you wanna trap both rangers, you do have to do that. Because right now you can't really trap both. You can only trap one.
Mm.
But if you do want to trap both of them, you have to stall, get your character stall in a way that traps both of them without them attacking you. So my 600 and 8-600 team, they ended up doing that.
Oh yeah, so, the 8-600 was completed. I don't think you were on the team in the actual completion of it, but you were definitely a big part of that.
Oh yes, I was asleep when they started running. I woke up, tuned into Kirby's stream. Then I was like, "Wait, they got the completion! Let's go!"
Holy, that was crazy. Because I was thinking the 25-minute 8-man wasn't going to be able to be done until like raids 4 at weapons.
A lot came of out, people so. Thought that, but half the team did Sims, did Calcs, did what do you call it? Estimations of like our PBs and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And like pretty much everything added up. We just needed like one, not die, and two, to actually like have the RNG needed. So the RNG, the biggest RNG part was having level 3 Zed back as a third room. That one was really important, because if you do a level 4 Zed back, one, you have to Karis. And that spec could have gone to ZCB. True. So having level three, you're able to heal through redemption. Level 4, you can't really do that. So instead of our specs going to Karis, or instead of our specs going to sustain, we can use that for damage instead. And it turns out that level difference saved a whole minute.
Wow, and that was like, I mean, I guess technically you could have still done it. It just would have been way more difficult. Because I swear, you guys, like, what was the actual finishing time with that sub 25?
I have it right here. 24:37.2.
Jesus, just demolished it. Like, that's crazy.
Yep. No, we're hard rolling for a level 3 Zebek.
Yeah,
you pretty much that was like the biggest time save, or that was like the only thing that keeps us from like getting the completion.
Interesting. Wow. Yeah, that was a crazy feat. And that takes so much coordination. That's actually that was probably one of the coolest things to watch is like pure
Out of
coordination.
like all the TA challengers, I do think that one's the hardest
Yeah,
that
I
I've
mean, it
ever
just
been done.
takes literally seven other people that need to be very, very competent. So
Competent, yeah, pretty much. Like it's a lot of people to be on the same track.
yeah, but
It's easy
that's
for one person to be on track, but to have all seven other people, it's like really hard.
Really, really cool. Is there anything else in ToA that you'd like to touch on before we move on?
Oh, so Oh, my first 600 completion. This one's just like, so I think this happened after the fan kit update. Oh, wait, a week after the fan kit update. They replaced silent prayers with the new deadly prayers. Yeah. Then that was it. That made it possible for Max and Noah to be completed.
So was this the 1+2 invocation, or 1+2 600 invocation?
Oh no, this is before this.
Okay.
So I actually have a video of it for of
Oh, I see. This is the one. It's September 14th, right? I'm just looking at your Twitter. It's like the 540 and then
Yeah,
575 into 600.
I also have a video. So I was pushing for like the highest info record, and on the same day, ended up getting the 540 completion, which became the highest at the time. Then after the update, I was like, oh, I'll just. People told me that you can do max info, so I was like, okay, then I'll do a 575 first, then a 600 invocation after. On that same day, I completed all three of those invocations.
That is so crazy. And this is when, I mean, nobody was pushing beyond 500. And very, very few people were even doing 500s. They're just doing it for their
Yeah.
kits. Jesus Christ.
I still remember the moment when I completed it, because this is getting that completion. I think most people in is what most people know me by. And right after I got the completion, so on your what do you call it, stream manager, you know how you see your followers slash bits slash so that after right after I got the completion, that activity feed swarmed with followers. I couldn't even read them, because it was just getting spammed with like followers. I'm like, what the heck? Then actually like. I wish I had a clip of it, but what do you call it? I actually teared up when I saw that.
Aw, shit. That's so cool, though.
Because literally that day, that same day, my follower count doubled with
That
that
is
one
nuts.
completion. Then like I also thought like this many people are like willing to watch me.
That's really cool. So, I mean, well deserved, too. I mean, people, I mean, it's just, these are just the craziest things ever, especially so early on, within the first month, being able to get a max. I mean, obviously not the time, but like still running a 600 is just nuts. So, what now was this 600? Was this with all the updates that we have now? I can't remember when the changes happened.
Let's see, it happened like mid-September.
Yeah. So, well, at least was the shadow buffed at this point? I can't remember all the
It
updates.
was still it was buffed, but for some reason they didn't have that the 4x accuracy went unnoticed, and so people actually like labbed it out, and they told Jadrix like, hey, you guys forgot to add the said accuracy.
Okay, yeah, I do recall something like that. So your shadow still wasn't perfect, but it
Yeah,
was still unaffected.
I
That's
was missing
funny.
the accuracy. I noticed too that I was splashing a lot.
That's interesting. So you just thought you were having that damage. So maybe the placebo effect helped, right?
In a way, I noticed it because I saw the damage, but I was noticing I was so splashing.
Yeah, just getting with unlucky, max, right? That's
probably with max mage plus Seer's Ring and then Turbo Boots. I was like, how am I splashing, man?
That's funny. Okay, so I'm actually just looking at your Twitter at this point. So it was the 500 into that, 540, 575, 600, into the 770 where you got banned for 2 weeks. And then basically doing 500 invocations with very minimal gear, kind of just proving that you don't
need
best in slot.
So at that time, there were so many people saying you cannot do this raid. You cannot do a 500 in budget gear. Then I was just like, yes, you can. I wanted to prove people that it's possible.
Yeah, but then people are just going to be like, well, you're just built different. So, this isn't,
I'm just looking back at that tweet. Cold One says Reddit has no excuses anymore because people were also thinking that it was impossible with low budget gear.
I just love Puggin saying stop, man. Oh my god, that's awesome. And then let's see, scrolling up. So what was the 1+2 600? That must have been insane because I remember retweeting that. That was.
So this one was obviously for those who don't know what 1+2 is, it's pretty much just you alone, but you have two alts in the raid to scale for you. And sometimes you can even use them to help you out as well. In this case, I only use them as supply alts. Mm. So compared to the normal 600, my average times would be 50 minutes, but since it's a 1+2, this run ended up being 3 hours. So the strats here, some rooms I do have to play differently. So for Kefri alone took 56 minutes.
Jesus Christ. Yeah, no thanks. No thank you on that one. 56 minutes.
Yep.
Yep.
Then
is that fun? I just need to ask. I mean, there's probably people wondering, is that fun? Are you having a good time during that? Because this is pure concentration for that long.
Oh, definitely. Because what do you call it? It's a in this scale and this challenge, you have to play differently compared to a normal 600.
Mm.
So there is that uniqueness to a challenge. And that's why I think it is tedious, yes, but it was also fun at the same time because it is something entirely different.
And it is a huge challenge to surmount, basically, mm-hmm. in order to maintain that focus. Do you ever struggle with focus when things get close? I don't know, the pressure you're under, does that ever get to you? I know it does for Saxophone. I just had him on. He was saying that nerves get to him really badly sometimes.
For the most part, no, but the only pressure I've really felt is from my chat whenever I'm streaming. So
yeah, you have to make them. Let me ask: is it the fear of failing, or is it the fear of letting them down and realizing that you have to watch all this again?
For your love, really, just letting them down.
Yeah, I see.
Because I want to I want to get the completion, but mm-hmm. If I don't get the completion, it'd be wasting people's time.
Yeah. I feel that. That is so crazy, though. Okay, so looking, if you had anything else on that, I'm just.
So during the Awakened release, Awakened Bosses release, another thing that pressured me was people were saying that you caught up to Sync and Addy in such a short amount of time. And then I'm just like, oh, that's interesting. Then people are telling me, try to beat them, please. I'm like, I'm trying, man. I don't know how to do Leviathan.
Oh my god, that was actually crazy. I do have to give a shout out to Sync for being the first person to complete that. I swear, like
he has a touch for first. He has a touch for doing stuff on like first release. Not sure all people know that, but like
yeah, no, he does. I feel like that is a unique skill because you know people can get really really good and master things over time when metas are solved and stuff, but. To be able to pioneer stuff when it's first released, that definitely is a unique skill. So shout out to Sync for that. And I mean, he's not even like the most consistent player or streamer either. So he just pops out of the blue. Boom. Here you go. World first. So really cool. One plus seven insanity. The fuck? What was this again? I liked it back then, but can you explain that?
So this is a...
So that is the CA task called Insanity, yeah. Right? Or something.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's perfect Gordon's, but you have to do it on a 300 level. And I happen to do it for seven other people alone. on the same raid.
And that was where part of your 60 bill came from.
This was on stream, so I just tell whenever it's on stream, I just tell people like first come, first serve.
Oh, that is awesome.
I do this for mainly 1+7 hits, for perfection on hits. But yeah, you gotta get into like 1+ it's first come, first serve. Like I don't like reserve spots for people. So
damn.
And during this day, I just happened to say, like, I want to do Insanity.
That is so cool.
So how it goes is since the power rooms don't matter, I just need their help DPSing through the rooms until I get to P1 Warden. And everyone P1 does have to participate during Obelisk, because if you fail the big ball, which everyone has to be DD'd for, mm-hmm. it fails a task for everyone. So people have to help me there. Then after P2 and P3, it's all up to me from there on out.
Was it a one and done?
Stream? It was actually Jesus. One and done. Oh, surprise, it was a one and done.
That is so cool. That's so much pressure, because then you actually do have people like relying, like hoping that they get the task done. That's
yeah.
crazy.
I do think Insanity is much easier than Perfection of Hat.
Oh yeah, Perfection of Hat is probably the most. So is that probably the hardest task in CAs for TOA? Do you think?
So in my opinion, the two hardest CAs, aside from the speed task, is Insanity and Perfection of Hat.
Okay.
But mainly on stream, I do Perfection of Hits because those are actually much quicker to do compared to Insanity. In my 1+7 Insanity, P2 Warden took a very, very long time. And I could have done like multiple, I could have done like two perfection of hits in the time I was at P2.
How many downs is it for P2 in that scale?
I don't remember exactly, but it was a lot of downs.
Okay, so looking up, this was also crazy. So this is back when there was a plugin available. No stun, awaken Leviathan.
Oh, this one.
Bruh. How much practice did this take?
So this was actually my second completion of no stun. So the first one, this is during when that plugin controversy was around.
Mm-hmm.
The sounds plugin, or visual sounds plugin.
Yes. And so let me just explain it maybe for those that maybe don't remember, but it was a sound plugin that will load up the queue as the attack is showing, correct? Like, so you basically have within 0.6 seconds to react to these things. But plus, on top of that sound thing, there's also a visual indicator that you could place somewhere on your screen that would show the color of the attack on the tick, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Then Jadix didn't like how it was being used in that way. and they removed it, and then all the controversy started. So when I posted it in my clan, there my own clanmates are like calling me like, "Not do without the plugin." Actually, yeah, they said, "Not do without the plugin," and I was like, "Okay." So, overall, practice wise, it took me 2 days to build a muscle memory to react to the prayers.
Whoa, wait, wait, wait,
And
wait, wait, wait. This was without the plugin?
the second, so the screenshot you're seeing right now,
Yeah.
this is my second clear without the plugin.
What the fuck? Wait, what? I thought this was
And
with the plugin. I just thought it was like I mean, I'm checking the date now, but holy
my first one
shit.
was out without the plugin, but I didn't like post it on Twitter. I just posted it in like some Discords. Yeah, but this is the second one without the plugin. And
That.
yeah, they have a whole video on that too.
Okay, I need to see that. Can you link that to me?
This is
Bruh.
one of my proudest edits.
Bruh. How is this even possible? Okay, I need to see this. I never ended up watching this. Okay, I'm just gonna skip to the. This is so crazy. So, okay, explain like the muscle memory that you needed to
So, do you see the volume level
Yeah, up here it says
tracker on
time to
the left?
react. Yeah.
So, pretty much level 7 is where some people refer this term to zero tick, but pretty much you have to pray on the same tick it gets released. It has to be the same tick, otherwise you'll take damage. So, I wanted to build a muscle memory for me to react to every single orb.
How is that even possible?
Well, I did a bit of like research of reaction times, so I think average, crap, I don't remember the average like reaction time. Let me look it up. So 200 ms, I think it translates to 0.2 seconds.
Yeah.
And then you also have like game delay too. And I think that adds up to like, well, my game delay, I think, adds up to like 0.3.
Dude, I'm just. Yeah, keep
So pretty
going.
much like, if done correctly, I could like possibly do it.
Bro, I'm just looking at how fucking wonky the volleys look. They're just literally just insta like magneting to you. That's so funny. Holy shit,
Oh no.
dude.
Another thing about like reaction timing is it does take some time to like aim and click. So that's also like that's also like more time onto reaction.
Yep, it's not just being able to click within that
Yeah. So
time.
I think just reacting alone averages like 200 ms. Then point clicking is like on average like 300 ms. Then you also have like latency in game. I think mine added up to like 0.2. So
Dude, this is nuts. Okay, so it looks like you did make a mistake in the beginning. Maybe you make a couple more. Would you go back here and try to do a perfect completion of it?
eventually, I want to go for rec using this method.
Oh my God. Well, wait, not wreck of going for most orbs. Or
Or for like speed wreck,
okay, speed wreck, I was gonna say. Cause this
because
would technically be the fastest way to complete it, right?
yeah, this is pretty, yeah, no doubt about it. If I just hit and
Jesus
not die,
Christ.
I can get wreck, and I know the wreck holder right now, he pretty much did Leviathan normally. The only exception, but yeah, nothing special, just like ZCB rolls at the beginning and stuff. So he did the boss normally, and my no stack completion is almost is close to wreck by like 7 seconds,
Wow.
even with me losing a lot of ticks by eating. So if I did practice enough, I think I can get the wreck back.
Those are some nice edits, by the way. I'm impressed. That was nice.
thank you.
That was a nice watch. That is so crazy. So you did. So you said it took a couple of days to really start getting that muscle memory down.
Yeah.
Oh my god, that is so nuts. Because I remember, yeah, No Monkey was trying to do it on stream, and even with the plugin back then, I mean, that was just. Yeah, I mean, even with the help, it was just you gotta be so inhuman, basically, to just be able to have these reflexes. So. That's crazy, dude. That is some crazy stuff. Okay, so let's see. After that, we already covered this one, which is the 25 Awakened Leviathans in one inventory. Can you explain? Okay, so now Leagues 4 dropped, and there's a couple things here before we get to the last one that I see. But you did a Jad special challenge, Trailblazer Reloaded exclusive, if you'll explain that. And then the 1,000 invocation completed under 25 minutes.
Oh, so the Jad challenge? So I didn't even know about it at the time until like someone told me. But when I found out about it, the same day, someone already had that completed it.
Mm.
So then I was like, oh. Let me just progress a little bit, then I'll try it.
So that was just the one where there's like additional minions. I didn't play it, but I think I saw like a couple.
Yeah. So each jet has like a set of minions. Then once you get to the last jet, jet becomes Fortic. Jet ends up becoming a Fortic. Fortic attack speed, and. What do you call it? Yeah, at the time I thought I was like the first, but yeah, apparently it's like some. When I found out about it, the first day I found out about it, someone had already done it.
Mm. Okay, what about the 1,000 invocation?
1,000.
Explain for those, because I don't really know what that all entailed. The 1,000.
So the 1,000 invocation, it's pretty much all invos, but there were two invocations that added. I think, yeah, 200 levels. And people thought it can only be done in a team, but I just sent it in the solo to see how it is. So, and shout out to Bodhi for, what do you call it? For shouting me out on this. So when I started the stream, literally, I had my title as 1,000 invocation attempts. Then literally, like, I was trying to figure out like how I'm going to gear and stuff, and I was just making potions while I was like thinking about like how it's gonna go. I literally had like a bunch of people like tuning in, you know, saying that, oh, we came from Bodhi. I'm just like, what the heck? I haven't even done anything yet.
You're just on his radar. You're on a lot of people's radar, I think. 1,000 though, and in under 25 minutes, so it stayed 1,000.
So I did two runs. So the first one was it was just a normal completion. I ended up getting like 29 minutes. So that completion, I thought I needed better gear or slightly better gear to get the completion. But then when I attempted again on the same day, I ended up like zooming past the rooms. Like crazy. I'm like, what the heck is going on? Because I didn't even have an imbued heart at the time either. So I thought I needed that to actually like get the clear.
So was there anything like particularly difficult? I mean, obviously you have all the leagues perks and stuff. Was there like what was like the hardest part about it?
There wasn't much difficulty. The only difficult part was like trying to get as fast as possible.
Mm. Was so it RNG also, dependent, do you think? Or was it pretty easy to, as long as you play perfectly, to be able to get it in under 25?
I was trying to play perfectly as much as I can. Then I think in this run, I played carefree much, much better. I think that was the biggest time save. Then, oh, I remember. So for my first run, I ended up having a three down warden because it had really, really bad RNG. But the second run, I added a two down warden instead, because I was actually hitting average this time.
Damn! So that was basically what solved it. Like,
yeah, Kefri and P2 warden.
Okay. Wow. And then I guess just recently, not ToA related, is the Solo Nex completed world's third. So that was really cool to see. Just within the span of a couple days, it seemed like Sacripillar, then No Monkey. No Monkey was second, is that right? And then you?
No Monkey was fourth.
Oh, who was second?
Sax.
Wait, who? Oh, okay. So you're including poor Kazard's.
Yeah, of course you like include the guy who did it in the first place.
That's true. Very humble. I mean, I guess you could argue that it is a different method at this point, but yeah, I guess it is still solo next. So, wow. What did that? Was that difficult for you?
I didn't. What do you call it? So, I wish Saxon mentioned this to me earlier about the tickets, because mm-hmm. that actually killed me a couple of times. They told me I was like chancing the combo eats. I'm like, wait, what? Then he was like, oh, that's also what the locator orb is for, so you can tiki properly. I'm like, oh, I wish I knew this earlier.
So at least what I talked to with Sax was basically like, it is possible to do it entirely without RNG. So basically, if you do play perfectly, you can get it
done. Yeah, for the most part, it's yeah. For the most part, if you have even if perfect play and next wants to screw you over, you can still like get through the run.
But you need to be like super giga attentive, basically, because there are some weird things that it can do.
Yeah, so pretty much you gotta be prepared for those scenarios if mm-hmm. if you want to get consistent clears.
That's crazy. And I know No Monkey, I believe, still holds world record for it. I don't think there's many people going for it, but like he's trying to go for a sub. Did he get a sub 20?
I'm not sure. But literally, I think the only people who can do it anyone can do it, really. But yeah. The only completions right now is me, Noob, and Zax.
That's so still. So, wow. That's funny.
So I think him having the title record is like very easy
for him. Do you think that it's like a matter of skill and like people are just like kind of scared of it, or do you think it's just people see it and they're like, that's just not even worth my time? Like that's just like
I think most people see it as like it's not worth my time, because a lot of this fight is tick eating and being prepared for like awkward scenarios where you do have to like tick eat or like run and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's just very tedious.
Yeah, it very definitely looks fight. Very it looks very tedious. Do you think? Okay, so I actually asked this to Sax as well. I want to ask you: did you ever do a solo TOB?
Solo TOB, I have, yes. Okay. This is a long, long time ago. This is like way before I even started streaming. So, I don't have a hardcore completion, but I have a normal completion.
Okay. Was this pre-Blood Fury or post?
Post-Blood Fury.
Okay.
So, what do you call it? I was surprised when I started attempting. My first attempt, I got to P2 Verzik. I'm like, what the heck happened?
Holy shit. First attempt?
Yeah, it was first attempt.
What?
How does it... Then, yeah, I was just like... How did I get through Nilo? That proficient, because the attempts after that, I struggled with Nilo, but the very first one, somehow I made it to P2 Verzik. I'm just like, what the heck?
That is a great, but you would probably
that was like the biggest fluke I've ever had.
That's crazy. So how many attempts did it end up taking you if you almost
I completed it in 4 days.
Wow. It's pretty crazy.
I had a lot of trouble with Nilo.
Yeah, that seems to be like the kind of gatekeeper, at least what I've heard.
Then people tell me about Zarpus, so before I started attempting, I actually practiced a lot with Zarpus pathing. Because you have to path differently in solo Zarpus. Then you have to do that step under method to save some tiles.
So was basically like, what was the hardest part for you? So like besides Nilo's, was P2 Verzik pretty difficult, or was it just nerves?
So I'd say it was just Nilo, but P2, I died a couple of times at P2 Verzik because there were some tiles that made her attack go from five, from ticking at 4 ticks to 5 ticks. If that makes sense. So it's, sometimes, yeah, depending where I'm standing, it would be considered too far for me to like ticky. Then I would like, I would accidentally ticky early a couple of times, and I would end up dying. Yeah, that killed me. Then I was like, oh, the video I watched didn't mention this.
Yeah, that's something you have to figure out on your own.
Yeah.
Hemmies has a couple questions. If you had the budget, would you outsource editing / creative work to others for the sake of a better / more time efficient product, or do you find the craft too personally meaningful? I guess we'll just answer that first one first.
A little bit of both, because I do want to, because after making my videos, I do want to edit more, but I just haven't, like, I don't know what to make really. Like, I do have like one plan, which is the 27 orbs, Leviathan.
Mm-hmm.
But like after that, it's just like, what do I work on next? Like, I don't, yeah, I really want to edit more, but I just don't like have, I don't, just don't have assets of my own to work with. So venturing out like that would be, would allow me to like practice more and stuff.
Okay, he also asks, you have unlimited resources to make a cinematic magnum opus. What's it about?
If it's RuneScape, so this is something I really want to do. I really want to get into Blender animations. So if I, then I would wanna recreate iconic quest scenes or iconic like quest fights in a like really epic way. But if it's outside of a RuneScape, it'd be something like it'd be something Gundam related. Gundam's it's a giant robot anime, and it is very popular in Japan.
So Saxer Pillar asks, or he says, obligatory, do you like the current state of the Soul Reaper axe / what would you do to it if you were to have complete creative freedom with it?
I had two different ideas for this one. So one of them was, I feel like Sword Axe is sort of wasted potential. I think it should be, in some places, just as good as Scythe. People might hate me for that, but in a way, it should be a double-edged sword, but on par with Scythe at the same time. So I make it, I'm not sure if I could be called. Another thing was, what is keeping the amount of stacks you have when switching weapons. Because right now, if you swap out weapons while having 5 stacks, you'll immediately lose all of that.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. So you would prefer it to kind of sort of stay similar to what it is right now instead of a full rework. Some people are advocating a full rework entirely.
Or full rework would be nice, but at the same time, full reworking stuff is kind of like a lot of work.
And it comes with its own problems. It could have,
yeah,
be just as bad. Interesting. So do you think that would be good enough if it just kept its stacks? And do you think that the stacks should still deplete over time?
Yeah, unless if you enter an instance.
Because
it does go away if you enter an instance, no matter like how many stacks you have.
Really? Interesting. Yeah. Okay, well, I know there's probably some negative consequences in regards to PvP, you know, being able to hold a stack indefinitely. But yeah, that's kind of hard to like sort of balance around, because I think that's the main reason why it depletes in the first place and why you can't switch weapons. But again, it's just one of those things where it's just, I don't know. It's not good enough in PvM. Yeah, and not
it's only a very hard weapon to balance around.
Super. I mean, especially just with PvP in the scene, and in like, I don't know, it's just really hard to balance. It's just hard to balance PvP, honestly, especially at this point in the game where people are still capped at 99 HP. I guess you can kind of angler or brew up, but like, weapons are progressively getting more and more powerful. So you're just, we're going to hit a point very soon where just, bruh, we got to make some like super alterations to what's happening in PvP, because I don't know, people are just going to be one-shotting. I mean, you can already one-shot people with enough RNG, but like, that's going to become way more common, I feel like. So that's not my expertise by any means. I'm not in the scene of PvP, but something to consider.
Yeah, I'm not a little person in PvP as well.
Yeah. Okay, let's see. Sido asks, why do you always say sick invite? And why do you have a Bakugan as a profile picture?
This freaking guy, I swear. Okay, so the sick invite, so that's a catchphrase of mine. I always say as a joke. It was originally from me. It came from a friend of a friend.
Okay. You know,
there was one time where he would just say, like, sick invite to this. Like, oh, we're doing content, sick invite. We're going to talk about sick invite. And it's like, bro, you live in Illinois. But yeah, then I eventually, being around him, I eventually like did the same thing.
That's so funny.
So like,
it's funny how like those phrases like just catch on, like they become like, kind of parasitic. Yeah. Like you just start. Yeah, I mean it's the same thing with just streamer lingo. Like if you're on Twitch enough, like I am, you start picking up what other people are saying and just everything. It's funny.
I don't see as much because apparently like most of Bliff. Most of the people don't like me saying that. They think I'm annoying now. So I don't say that much in game, but outside of the game, I do say that to other friends.
Okay, let's hear about the Bakugan profile picture.
So this guy. So it's not a Bakugan. Don't listen to this evil man. So it is from Gundam as well.
Okay.
But it is a combination of one of the robots plus the mascot. So the mascot is a ball. It's a robot ball. Let me show you a picture. So here's the mascot. Then the robot I came from, or the robot design came from, is let me find it right here. So it's a combination of these two designs into one. It's a fan art.
Interesting. Yeah, the first little guy just looks like a tennis ball. He looks like a looks like a tennis ball with some red eyes. I see.
Yeah.
So it's not a Bakugan. What is it called?
It's called a Horrible.
Horrible.
Spell after you. Horrible.
So why does Sido say it's a Bakugan? Is he just trying to upset you?
Yes, and funnily enough, most people that see my profile pic and that have like don't know what it is, unless if they're also a Gundam fan. If they're a Gundam fan, they actually know what this is.
Mm.
But since they aren't, one of the popular terms that people would guess is Bakugan. God, I hate explaining that. Then the other one, someone would say. Someone would say it looks like a Pokemon.
That's what I thought at first. I thought it looked like a Pokemon.
Yeah, you too. It's a Bakugan Pokemon.
Actually, you know what it looks really what it looks like? Is it looks like a Yu-Gi-Oh. Actually, no, not a Yu-Gi-Oh. It looks like a Digimon. Actually, not Digimon. Quite. I just remember watching Digimon as a kid. I actually don't really recall what those things look like. I think they were more like monster-esque.
Yeah, they looked like monsters.
Yeah, so maybe not quite. But yeah, my first thing was I thought it was definitely a Pokemon. But okay, let's you know what? Before I continue with these topics, I actually want to get your overall thoughts on the Colosseum, and mainly because I'm just excited for it, and I'm excited for you and some other Giga gamers to get super, super just into it and see how far you guys can take it. Yeah, I'm eager to see whether the glory system is going to be something we gauge as like the determining factor if people are good, or if it ends up being more like speed running. Because I think Saxerpillar kind of brought up that point. Like,
well, you're obviously going to have speed running in like pretty much every content. There's always like some sort of speed run that can be implemented.
But do you think that will be what we really gauge as important in skill level? Or do you think just getting to as high of glory as possible would be the gauging factor? Or both? I guess
technically
both.
Depends. It depends what they really want to do. If they want to add in speed or like a time limit, then you'll get rewarded for that. And that's like entirely up to them. Or maybe they can do both and just have like, people can like look at it two different ways.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking. I'm excited though.
I don't think they'll like add both. I'm pretty sure it's gonna end up being one factor.
Yeah. I mean, officially, I think it'll only be glory. But I just am wondering what the player consensus is gonna be. Mm-hmm. What really matters. I'm really excited though. I know the rewards are kind of lackluster. A lot of people aren't really super excited. I mean, obviously the quiver is amazing, but the other ones are kind of weak. But
I don't care much about the rewards. I just, for me, I just really care about the challenge.
Yeah, it depends how fun it is.
If the rewards aren't that good, then maybe the challenge is good then, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much Infernal. I mean, there's no, besides the Infernal, the Infernal Cape's amazing, but this is literally on that tier where it's like you get a quiver that's super, super good. It's like the new range cape. But yeah, there's nothing really beyond just getting additional Tackle and a pet. I'm really excited to see the Colosseum pet. I don't know if you watched the Winter Summit, but they did tease what some of those monsters would look like.
They teased a line of sight monster, right?
I can't remember exactly. I just remember like looking at them. There was like two that I saw.
Oh. I saw like a Minotaur looking one.
Yeah, that's one I saw. And there was like one different one. I can't remember. But we'll see if it has a bunch of transmog and stuff. I mean, it looks like, I don't know. Like what is your speculation? Do you think that it'll be a melee-based challenge? Or do you actually think it'll be like more of a range / melee or some even tribrid kind of challenge? Like, do you have any idea?
From the looks of it, like, just like on like first impressions of like the stage itself, it looks like it'll be like some melee / range, because it sort of dates back to like gladiator days, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And those days don't really iterate. Modern iterations of those don't really like seem to use magic.
So you think it'll be like melee range based? You think
melee range based? Probably, because range kind of plays a huge factor into the game.
Mm-hmm.
Blowpipe and Tebow are like the two mega weapons in game.
Plus, it literally drops a range cape, so that would make sense.
That too, yeah. Then you also have melee, rapier, fang, scythe. Scythe is also a really big one. I see that used a lot in Inferno for in speeds.
Mm-hmm.
And from the looks of that, that thing slaps. But so
so this is another point. In the Project Rebalance blog they were talking about adding additional like weaknesses to certain monsters. And this is a potential. It's not like it's guaranteed to come out. But yeah, they've kind of teased the potential of introducing three different range styles, not styles, but like I guess defensive styles. Like, so you can shoot with like a ballista, and that'll be like a heavy rain shot, and then there's going to be standard rain shot, and then a light rain shot, which is like darts. And again, this is all tease stuff. Like, it's not for sure, but it's coming in. I just wonder, though, if they're trying to sort of start implementing that before the... Like, I don't know. Like, I feel like the Colosseum has to come out beforehand. I feel like this would be a huge project to undertake.
That one seems a bit iffy, because another difference in those three weapons is attack range. Darts, if I recall correctly, that has like a 3-tile or 4-tile attack range. Mm-hmm. Like, darts alone, but yeah. Bullpup is like 5. And then Ballista, I think it's 9 tiles or 8 tiles. So somewhere around there. But even, yeah, they're... yeah, so they all vary in attack speed and attack range. And attack range is, what do you call it? It's kind of important too. Movement in game is very, very crucial. So for you to like run around a lot to like switch styles, you'll lose like a lot of run energy to that.
Mm-hmm.
So like, I think that one's a bit iffy if they were to implement that.
It would be interesting. I just, I get excited about the potential prospect. I know there could be some really crazy downsides to something like this if it's not balanced correctly. But I think part of the reason I get excited about this, and the reason I even bring it up for like in the Colosseum topic, is just wondering what the effects will be on that. Because ultimately, you know, like what you said, is like T-Bow and Blowpipe tend to be the go-tos with almost any range content. So this would add a little bit of diversity. But, I mean, you also heard that they're, I don't know if you heard this, but they're also potentially planning on adding elemental weaknesses to monsters.
Elemental, ooh.
Yep. So we will see about that. That is definitely going to be...
So,
yeah.
That one seems a bit iffy too, because elemental, so that means you have to use standard spellbook, right? And well, harmonized orb is not, if I recall correctly, not that great.
Yeah,
without the tome.
This would be a direct... Well, I mean, this would probably have to entail so many things. So it's not just keeping all the spells as is. They'd probably have to go and rebalance what the standard spells are producing. But on top of that, even charged staves would have one of the four elements. So what they're doing is...
Oh,
like air, okay. Water, earth, and fire are going to also include the ancient... sort of elements inside of those. So like, for example, the fire is blood, water is ice, whatever the other ones are. And so they're going to keep it as simple as possible. They're not going to add like 8 or anything. It's just going to stay with the 4.
Okay.
But the shadow,
yeah, that sounds a little better. Yeah.
Yeah. And the shadow would be like the, whatever it is, the earth or air, whatever it correlates to, that would have that weakness as well. So it's, interesting. I think it is exciting, and I think for the future, like obviously right now it would be kind of a mess because they're all, I mean, shadow is just like one of the best things ever, but ultimately if they did go with this system of adding elements to all monsters and adding a little bit of diversity in your arsenal, like that could be cool. But and it could help increase diversity going forward with future mage weapons. But
yeah, that sounds like
It's a huge project, and it's definitely going to like change metas entirely.
Yeah.
So that's the fear that people have. I'm excited about it personally because I think we are kind of slowly being gatekept with what we can introduce into this game. So I think something like this would be pretty game changing, but ultimately maybe good for the health of the game going forward. It's hard to know though.
Mm-hmm. Another thing is, so you know how this game is an MMO?
Yeah, I barely remember that. I'm an Iron Man.
There needs to be more group content.
Yeah, that is actually a common thing, that theme that's been brought up so much recently in the casts, is people really trying to push that. Like, this really is an MMO, and team content should be encouraged. Like, it should be. So you agree with that?
Yeah, so doing stuff solo is good, but we just need more group content, really.
Yeah, one of the things that was offered by Ron Plays Games recently was, you know, just making it so team content not only is like efficient to do, but also desirable. Like one of the saddest things is like chambers how, I mean, doing a 100 man chambers, like if you had 100 people in Ulm, that you're not finishing it. Like you're just gonna fucking, I mean, you're gonna finish it, but you're gonna have zero. You have negative points. Like that shit would be so impossible to try to like do. Anyway, I mean, maybe with some of the changes they've made to chambers, it's a lot easier at this point. But ultimately, what should have been the case is like adding more and more and more people to your chambers party should have not been a detriment, you know, ultimately. Like it should be encouraged to bring another person along. Like, oh, cool, we're going to get another helper, you know, in this raid. So I think going forward, they really need to push that. I agree. And I think ToA did a really good job. I think solos still are the best, but they're very, very close.
Oh, yeah, that would call it. And one thing they added to ToA that's really good is the red Karis. So that it is not good in solos. It is like troll if you bring in solos, but if you bring in teams. Yeah, it's actually really good.
It's a really cool item. Do you think it could get a buff, or do you like where it's at right now?
If they made it faster in attack speed after specking, I think that's the only like critique I have for red Karis. But overall, I think the red Karis is good where it's at. Oh, funny enough, during the release of ToA, I told everyone the yellow Karis is the strongest Karis there is, but people would be like, no, blue Karis is better because they do more damage on Kefri. I'm like, no, you only use that Kefri. Yellow Karis, you can use it anywhere. And not only that, but like if you do the math, like sure, you use 75% spec, but the healing value is insane. So pretty much,
so OP, yeah.
Pretty much, like two dose restores is how much is Karis heal again? Like 117.
I think it goes to one
around there.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. So like, you get that much healing value. You get that much value off two doses of restore, pretty much. So that's why I told people like if this were to come to main game as well, there would be a problem.
Oh yeah,
that Karis would be an absolute problem. So thank God it's only locked at ToA, but even though it's in ToA, it is so insanely strong that people kept telling me, people kept downplaying me, like, no, but blue Karis damage, right?
That's usually the case, though. It really is generally whatever device you cast.
Yeah.
Oh, this is the thing I wanted to ask in regards to like things exiting ToA and being introduced to the main game. What are your thoughts on sort of like spec pots, not exactly adrenaline pots, but slowly regens over time. The like adrenaline pots that why am I spacing what they do? Because I've been so focused on like the spec pots where I've talked about this idea where like a spec pot would have four doses, just like a normal potion, where each dose heals 25% of your spec, and you can just drink them whenever. But they'd be very expensive. What are your thoughts on something like that in the main game?
In main game, so if we're to, so say if I could like have a full enemy with them, that'd be insane for pieces of content.
Would it be bad though?
Be bad? That'd be good to like constantly spec, but I think it'll be bad for the game.
So let me just try to explain briefly what my thoughts are on it. And I am not necessarily advocate. I know it sounds like people are probably just thinking I'm obsessed with this idea. It's just food for thought, and it's just to kind of get people's opinions on it. I'm not advocating that this should come into the game, but I feel like people get the wrong idea when they think about a spec pot. So in my idea, this spec pot would be expensive, probably cost, you know, in between 100 and 200K. That's ultimately what I'd kind of want it to be at. But It would just be like a normal potion where it takes three ticks to drink each one. So you couldn't technically just constantly, well, with most things you probably could constantly spec, but the problem is that you're pot blocked. So like you wouldn't be able to drink other pots. Not like that would be a big problem. But on top of that, these potions wouldn't really be able to be brought into most sort of speedrun content. For example, Inferno and CMs, like you just don't have the space for it. So in a lot of these typical speedrun content, you wouldn't be able to optimize these. And it also wouldn't be something you're using to just farm bosses if you're trying to make money, because you're just spending so much money. But for things like for really quick fights that you're trying to get a new PB in, like for Zora or GG's or whatever you're trying to like get your rubies in or whatever, this would be a really fun thing to use. But it would be very expensive to use ultimately. So I guess part of it is like, would this be a good potion to introduce? Because I don't think it's fully necessary, but I do think there could be some instances where this thing could be really fun to use in certain pieces of content. I don't know if that kind of helped explain it a little bit more, if you already were thinking of those things.
Yeah, so if we took out like GP out of it, now we got to consider like, what if people actively use this on a daily basis?
Yeah.
So it'll be a huge advantage in certain pieces of content. So I think I don't do Infernal Speeds, but I think it'll be like super useful there for Infernal Speeds.
But where? And how are you even like how many are you bringing into Inferno basically? Because like you need so much space for other potions and gear and stuff. So I can't even see people bringing it into Inferno, honestly.
I would assume just class picking, really.
Yeah, and but the
downtime between waiting for waves is when you can like drink it and stuff.
Yeah, but I'm just wondering, like, you have the full Inferno to do. Like, what are you replacing restore pots with these? Like, and how many are you bringing? If one pot only restores 100 spec, so I'm not saying adrenaline pots from ToA, but I'm saying like
one dozen.
Yeah, yeah. Like so one dose only heals 25. But it is a 4-dose pot. So you drink it, you have a full 100 spec again, but that's an entire potion gone. So ultimately, like these things in long content, I can't actually even see it being brought in because it's just not worth the inventory space. Same thing with CMs. Like you just don't have the space for it.
For CMs, that one seems like more understandable because you're squeezing in so much gear.
Mm-hmm.
But for Inferno, you're squeezing in a lot of restores. So I think like if you were able to like constantly claw spec a minion, you'll get a lot more value than just you'll get a lot more value from that alone.
But you'd only be able to get 2 claw specs in per potion. So how many potions are you bringing into the Inferno?
That's I forgot claws take 50%.
Yeah. So this isn't having everything like an adrenaline pot. That might be the confusion.
Mm.
This would simply be, so I shouldn't have even like brought up the adrenaline pot example, because this would be an entirely different potion. That's just a spec pot.
95% each dose. Okay, that makes it iffy then. Yeah.
I mean, you probably would want to bring in maybe a couple, and that would kind of actually diversify the meta potentially, where there are some times where you will want to drink this, but and you'll have to be a little bit more careful on your restore usage. But and don't get me wrong, like this would definitely have some effects on the major effects on other speedrun content that are shorter fights. For example, one of the places where this would be so OP is the Awakened bosses. You go in and just keep drinking spec pods down and keep void wakering a bajillion times, like trying to kill this thing. But I wonder if it was expensive enough, if it would actually just be something where like, I don't know, like this would have severe consequences. Don't get me wrong. But I just wonder, like, would it be interesting enough to allow this into the game? Because I mean, I'm just thinking of like Awakened Vardorvis right now, where the entire time you're just void wakering just over and over, keep drinking another I guess technically you couldn't do it repeatedly over and over because the void waker is 4 tick and it would take 6 ticks just to drink 2 doses of this. So
it's gonna be worth it because you're those hits will be guaranteed damage, and sometimes you can hit a zero with your main weapon.
Yeah, 100%, 100% it would still be worth it. And you'd probably just do a few weapons. You'd probably like switch to like, a scythe in between while you're just healing up to full again, then go back to Void Waker quick. But it would cost a lot. So, you're you know, spending a mil per kill if you're just chugging these things constantly, and you could still die. I mean, Awakened Vardorvis is no walk in the park for most, you know, mortals. I guess you're pretty consistent at it at this point, I imagine. But what do you think of the effects on that, like something like that?
So I do think it'll definitely be an advantage, even though like it'll be super expensive. Mm-hmm. There's people that are rich enough in game that are willing to like spend that much money.
Mm-hmm.
I'm one of those, of course, I'm one of those examples. With orbs.
So is that a problem? because the people that are already rich enough don't even have a problem getting Blood Torva in the first place. Most of them are pretty damn good at the game. So you would have, like, I guess my problem with it initially was maybe some noobs will come in and just bring a bunch of spec pots. But ultimately, that's their prerogative to just go in and bring a bunch of these things. They would still end up dying to the awakened versions because they're very tough, but...
I do think it'll be a problem because I think special attacks or specs should be like a special weapon. It's not, not something you can like main hand really.
Yeah, no, that's fair. That's a fair point. I just don't think long term people will just be splurging on these repeatedly because of just the sheer cost to it. Even if people are rich, what is the point of you using these at this point then? If you're like, are you planning on increasing your bank value or just having fun? Because that would be the point of bringing these spec pots if you are already rich enough. Like you do get the luxury of just having a lot of fun and just specking bosses repeatedly if you wanted to. I just wonder. I mean, don't get me wrong, this would be so game-changing, and I'm really just playing devil's advocate here. I'm just trying to see any true negatives toward this that would be extremely detrimental to the game's health. I just don't see it. I just don't see true detriments besides, you know, people just having a wild time at some bosses and just repeatedly specking and just, you know, forking out 2 mil or something, what it would cost to use it.
If we're able to spam spec, then that'll be their main weapon instead of like scythe camping and such.
Yeah, so, it would. But what's the problem with it? Like, what's the ultimate? Is it just because now speedruns are just laughable? Is that like the main thing that goes wrong with like short bosses become like a laughable thing? Because. Again, like people are rich, that's fair, but you're never going to be making money. Like, why exactly are you killing? I don't know. I guess I'm just trying to understand, like, is it so wrong that somebody that's super, super wealthy gets to use these repeatedly, not making any money? So it's not like people can be overly jealous of like, oh my God, this guy gets to constantly spec. Like, he's just splurging mills and mills and mills using these things, especially if they were worth like 200K each. You know what I'm talking about? Like that would, for two additional, for one additional, like 50% spec costing 100K every single time. And you do have to drink these. I don't know. I'm going on this topic a lot, but I'm just, I guess I'm just.
No, it's definitely like something like worth like considering.
Yeah.
Okay. Crap, I just lost my train of thought. Oh. I had something else in mind. So it would butcher like a lot of methods to like if a lot of like normal speed methods. Yeah. But at the same time, there's some speed methods that require a bunch of RNG just to get through.
Yep, yep. No, I mean we literally see that with like Mulgo, Kirby, Zolra. I mean, you're just praying. And there's even things like, for example, I believe the speedrun Vardorvis is literally like relying on a Ruby proc, like two Ruby procs or something just to get that speedrun. Like what, like is that, like is that any more fun? Is that any more like not busted than just, I don't know, using these spec pots? I mean, and there's very, very few people that go for these super, super speedruns on short-term bosses, like under a minute, you know? And these I actually think would actually add more excitement to a potential speedrun ultimately, being able to drink these things. So it's not as RNG dependent, But I mean, there still would be a huge RNG element to get the world records in these, but I don't know.
So, if something like that would be introduced, it'll make things more consistent.
Yeah, I mean, technically, there still would be a huge RNG element to squeeze in that very last tick, you know, that you're trying to get. Yeah. But you're right. Yeah, I like to bring it up because I get fascinated by the idea of it.
It's definitely something that's iffy.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, this is also like something new into the game.
Yeah.
So there's a bunch of places that I can't really think of the top of my head where it'd be like advantage or like game breaking or a disadvantage. So yeah,
There's definitely some crazy advantages. I think the biggest ones I think of on the top of my head are just the awaken variants. Like even something like awaken Leviathan, where you start off the enraged, hit two web weavers. Try to squeeze in two doses of, your drink. I mean, technically, it would be pretty hard for the average noob. If you're already getting to the Enraged Awakened in the first place and you have all this stuff, trying to keep track of the prayers on top of drinking two more sips of this stuff to hit another web weaver and then try to drink another two in the next six ticks and hit another web weaver, like, you got to be pretty damn good at the game already to pull that off in the first place. So even though it sounds like you're just making this whole thing easy mode, you still do have to have competency to be able to pull this stuff off. But the Awakened bosses, I think, for sure would be the place that they use these. And there's probably other scenarios where this becomes really, really busted. But ultimately, I'm like, I don't know. I kind of just get excited about the potential of different metas spawning because of it. But who knows? Who knows? Anyway, well, that's lost. I'll talk about it.
I do want to see something like spec related,
because
I do want to see a lot of writing coming into the game. So like different methods to be used to kill bosses and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Depending on whenever it's a new weapon or like a new piece of gear or like a new item that changes like the way you play.
Really. Yeah, that's what kind of gets me excited about it, honestly. What are your thoughts? I don't know if you watched the Winter Summit, did you?
I watched bits of it.
Okay.
I heard about Gothic, Wild Gothic Steeps.
Yeah, that's what I was going to talk about, actually. What are your thoughts on the God Alignment prayers they kind of teased?
I really like the idea of God Alignments. But one thing I do want them to do is like, This is a very hard task to do, but try to make them as equally as powerful as the other one. That sounds like a very hard task. So there's definitely going to be alignments where most people will end up using rather than the other one.
I think that's a brilliant point to bring up. It's like this is going to be very tough to balance, but ultimately what they would need to do is introduce it into the game with a caveat of, okay, this is not a finalized product. We're going to allow this into the main game, even after beta testing, and allow people a couple weeks to really mess around with this stuff. And we will make further tweaks and balances that feel necessary after player feedback. Because ultimately, what happens is, yes, metas are like one becomes the meta or two become the meta, and then the other ones are looked down upon. But all you have to do in that situation is look at why they are not being used and just make slight little tweaks to bring them all to a certain level. So over the next month or so, the team just has to be very, very aware, be just very on the ball about what the player feedback is and really listening to people about what could make these more balanced. Because I think they are trying to introduce like 6 or 8 different like God alignments, which would be crazy to balance.
Yeah, it's a lot. That's a really like hard, and that'd be really hard to balance out. Yeah.
Yeah, it's hard, but ultimately, what you need to do is just, you can't just drop the alignments and then not touch them again. Like you have to take the feedback that's being given because things can be balanced. They're not going to be perfectly balanced. There's always going to be one that's probably used the most, but at least they can be very, very close. So
yeah, Oh, another thing about feedback is when people give feedback, it actually has to be meaningful. Like, I've seen feedback saying that, oh, they should add this instead, but most of the time, they never explain why.
Yeah, there needs to be rationality behind the reasons. Yeah,
you can't just say, oh, this should be in game.
Yeah.
Yes, but why?
Yeah.
And just say, like, oh, we should rework Baba.
Yeah, just say that. Yes, that makes. Yeah. Don't listen to those.
But yes, but why?
Exactly.
But yeah, like definitely, like people don't like Baba, including myself. But at the same time, like when it comes to reworks and stuff, when it comes to full-on like boss reworks and stuff, mm-hmm. that takes a lot of time. Like redesigning the room, like potentially redesigning the room and like. Adding mechanics and such, that takes like a lot of time.
Totally. Ooh, okay, here's a good question from Okay Buddy. His second question, the first one we've already kind of touched on, but just talking about the fan kit and awakened bosses, but his second is, should there just be more than cosmetics for end game?
Definitely yes. Is that not only you get a cosmetic for completing, like, for example, the crime achievements, but it also gives people more of a reason to grind out for those other things that other endgame stuff has to offer. So pretty much it's more like content in the game that people can actually do.
What are your... Okay, so that's fair. I feel like we do have a... At least in my opinion, I think we do have a pretty decent balance of things that are not just cosmetic. I mean, one of those things, literally, when they're talking about endgame non-cosmetics is... Even though a Zuck Helm is a cosmetic, you get a lot of CA rewards that are actually very beneficial to your account. Same thing with, like, Infernal Cape. Same thing with... I'm trying to think what else... Well, I guess the quiver now is also going to be introduced. But I feel like there also is a place for purely cosmetics. For example, the Fang Kit and Blood Torva. If for example, Blood Torva came out and actually had higher stats, I actually don't think that would be healthy for the game. I think it is appropriate to have places that purely are just a flex because of the new look of the item. What are your thoughts? Well, at least in that particular example, let me ask you that. Do you think it was appropriate for Blood Torva to not have any stat upgrades and just be a cosmetic?
Yeah.
And why is that exactly? Like, can you, like, expand on it? Like, because that's really what I'm... Like, I've heard people... I think Travis42, I had him on several weeks back, and he was talking about, like, what if the Sanguine Scythe had additional stats? And... I personally just, like, yes, there's an argument to be had that, like, maybe this would be a good thing for the game potentially, but ultimately, I think the flex of the cosmetic alone is enough. And then as soon as you've added stats to it, now it's this thing that people need to do, basically, to get the best in slot weapon, and then that leads to maybe devaluations or boosting, like, increased boosting of hard motob or something like that that just... Right now, it really is just a matter of, you know, just do you want to get a nice little cosmetic for your account rather than, like, game-changing stats?
Actually, on second thought.
Yeah.
Yeah, that... I don't think that would be a bad idea, really. So, that... That gives... Yeah, that'll give players more motive... That'll give players an incentive to actually, like, grind for that certain piece of content.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I think there needs to be more to the content than currently what we have right now. So see like Armored Top, for example. I think if they want to make Scythe like much more stronger with the kit, I think hard mode top needs to be harder than what it currently is right now. Because even though it's like a harder difficulty, there It's been like, what, 2 years since it's been released? Pretty sure people can just do consistent runs. And what do you call it? I think it's been like that ever since it got released.
Yeah, it's not that much different.
It's not much of a difference. And I do think, like, that example alone, people getting consistent clears and stuff, I do think the content needs to be harder in for order to get those slight buffs.
I just fear that, well, and I'm not against things like that coming in the future where it's pulled and everybody's okay with it and we're going to come out with this new harder content that actually adds stat upgrades. I guess my fear with that example in particular of hard mode TOB, like, and I don't claim that you're advocating this at all because just the way it's already been in the game for multiple years at this point, but like, it just feels like as soon as you've added a new stat upgrade to something, it becomes essential. Like, people feel this new obligation to get it, and that has negative impacts, such as like boosting and such as maybe Jagex feeling the need to make stuff easier. Like, you can, I don't know, I just, for some reason, it just doesn't seem right. It seems like it's already enough for there to just be a cosmetic upgrade for most pieces of content. It's the same thing with the Fang kit. The Fang kit looks so goddamn good, looks so much better than the normal one.
Then, yeah, huge
it's
difference.
It's just like, there's not even, like, if you were to also,
night and day.
Yeah, like, if you were to also add on additional stats to the Fang, it just feels unnecessary. It's like, okay, the boosters are going to be happy as fuck because everyone's going to feel obligated to do this now, but I just don't feel like it's necessary.
At the same time, I don't think it's like really possible for them to do, because like, system limitations and like imagination limits and stuff. So to pull off something that completely a piece of content, which makes it super hard, but you do have to like, you do have to do it, is a very hard task alone. It's a very hard task for the devs alone. So yeah.
No, that's true.
I would like to see something like that, but it is, from the looks of it, it is unrealistic to see.
Okay. URC2 asks, would you ever be interested in a higher tier of Grandmaster challenges for a new cosmetic Zuck Helm, even though a Zuck Helm's already cosmetic, or even cosmetic Inferno Cape for a sub 45? I know people don't like a lot of cosmetics, but I'm all for the hardest achievements having something.
Definitely. So, yeah, not only it's a flex, but it is something that people, that would push people to grind for if they want it.
It'd be kind of cool to have, like, I wouldn't mind something that has an infernal attachment to it. So some sort of infernal cosmetic override that maybe adds like a gold trim or something. That would actually be ugly as fuck, but something that,
I mean, looks, depends. I mean,
the gold trim could look good, but I don't know, sometimes the gold trim starts looking like mustard. I worry about
it. You just have to see the design first before
No, for sure, but some sort of kit that's subtle, but it's enough to point out like, okay, this guy's a god gamer, and let's just say it is a sub 45 inferno for that. That would be kind of cool. I'd be okay with that.
Yeah, that'd be really cool to see. Thanks.
As long as you don't add stat upgrades. As soon as you start adding stat upgrades, then it becomes essential to do this, basically. I mean, don't get me wrong. There's an argument to be had to do something like that, but I feel like it would get voted no very quickly.
Well, in this case, if it's just going faster than usual, yeah, then I don't think it deserves a stat upgrade.
I see.
It just deserves like a mark of like prestige, saying that you did this and that you did this challenge and this piece of content.
Yep. Next question is, let's see. Ooh, okay, this is gonna be an interesting one. Jordan asks, who would be on your Mount Rushmore of PVMers? So I guess top four.
Mount Rushmore.
Mount Rushmore, like the four presidents on the mountain.
But, well, Wilkes, no, you can't eat. Wilkes has to be there, yeah, no matter what.
Of course.
Wilkes is the OG pioneer. Even though he doesn't play much anymore, he is still We have to like recognize his achievements when he was when he still had a passion for the game. Let's see. Yeah, Wooks. Exact.
Yep.
Then he said PvMers, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, so it looks exact. Or yep. Then
I'm throwing you up there on fourth, but you're gonna have to. You,
really?
You're gonna have to, you, yeah, you're gonna. And that's
you think
only.
I'm not good.
I think so. I think so. But
I don't think I'm not good.
Yeah, that's why I know I knew you weren't gonna say it. You're too humble for it. But I'm throwing you up there.
I seriously don't. I seriously don't think I'm not good.
Well, your achievements beg to differ. I'd throw you up there on fourth at this point. I'll have you answer your fourth, but before I let you, I did make that video talking about the top five greatest PvMers several months back, and you were actually just in the what's the name for it? the shoutouts at the end, basically like the honorable mentions. But this was before you had done, you know, the 25 awakened and the solo necks and the everything else. And don't get me wrong, Calvino and Unpredictable were the other two. And Unpredictable, it would be a very close one, I think. But I think just because you've been so active lately, it would put you up there on the Mount Rushmore in my person. And then this is, again, all subjective. It's all a matter of opinion, but I'm actually going to be getting Unpredictable on the cast in a couple weeks, actually. Oh. in a week, so that should be a fun one. But he's also God Gamer. It's a tough roll of the dice for the top four. But what would you say for your fourth?
I don't think I've heard much about Predictable.
Mm-hmm.
The only one I've known is his low level no pillar inferno, as if I'm
Yeah, he did a one defense melee, no pillar inferno.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. That was something else for sure. But he apparently has, I'll talk to him about this in a week, but he talked about, or somebody, met, I think it was Afsal, mentioned that he had a tweet. Actually, let me just look this up so I can get this right. Okay, this is the tweet. It says, this is September 29th of 2020. Oh, God, this was like a year and a half ago. Jesus Christ. So I've been logged out on Triple Jads for about a month and a half on an account with one defense, 31 prayer, 50 attack, with the possibility of...
And overheads.
Yeah, no overheads. With the possibility of completion. And he's at Triple Jads, yeah. And he's been there. And he's,
what the heck?
I have no idea. So apparently he's done something absolutely insane, and this would be the lowest combat. This is a year and a half ago, so I don't know if, I don't know. I'll talk to him about it. But like,
that's out of my league.
Something like that would be insane. But he hasn't done it yet. But. Yeah.
Wait. Anyway. No overhead. No overheads. That's impossible. It just. I'm not smart enough to figure that out.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a inferno connoisseur. So who would you put on your fourth then, if it wasn't for him? Or if it wasn't him?
I'm not sure, really, because. I don't really know that many people in the community.
Mm.
No, yeah, the only ones I know is Booksport, Exact.
Well, I'll throw you up there for my fourth if you're gonna remain unanswered, and you don't need to accept it. But I'm gonna push that, and I think
I don't deserve that spot.
Why is it always the? This is not addressed to you, but just my audience. It's always the most, the most giga gamers are always the most humble. It's crazy how that works.
Well, I'm not trying to be humble, and it's the truth. Like, what do you call it? So one reason why I don't think I'm that good is because, like, You can. I've heard that term thrown around to like a bunch of other people, but no one really elaborates like how I'm really good. I don't get that. Most people that when they say I'm good, they just say I'm good, and it's like, how though? How am I good? You know, like, yeah, I don't get really meaningful compliments about the gameplay. Just like straight up say, he's just good.
So. Well, I'll answer that for you. The feats you've done, I mean, just literally the ones we listed of just even just the ones on your Twitter timeline are things that are not capable of being done by, you know, 99.999% of players. So the fact that you've done so many, and I mean, just the variety of it all is pretty insane. So that's my reason. But anyway, now I'm just tooting your horn for you. I'm sorry to make you feel so uncomfortable, but anyway, no.
But
yeah.
But what do you call it? It's just, if anything, I get, if there's something I think I'm good at, it's about editing, because I get people would actually, when it comes to my editing, people are like, I'll actually elaborate like how good it is, so I actually believe them that it's actually good, because they see like they mention like bits of these, they mention bits of like parts of my videos,
mm-hmm.
and they'd be like, oh, this shot's really well done. This editing, no one has like what do you call it? Yeah, this piece of editing is like, or this piece of graphic is a really nice touch to show like to keep track of like the run and stuff. So yeah, I get more meaningful compliments about editing than gameplay. So that's why I don't think my gameplay is up there. I think the editing is up there.
Yeah, I mean, your editing is great too, but I'd beg to differ on the other, on the gameplay. So let's move on to this. Actually, this is funny. This is something we already talked about, but just expanding on it. Chick asks, "What did you do in that 2-week forced vacation from Jagex?" Do you have any other accounts that you were playing on, or did you just take a break? Just log
I had
on?
An alt, but like it didn't even have ToA completed. So, and I didn't have anything on that account either. So I was like, I'll just touch grass for once in a while. So I did hang out with my brother a couple of times. We went to like, We went to an arcade. So there's this game I play called Wangan Midnight Maximum Tune. It's a racing game. Even though I don't play, I destroyed him in that game. He's experienced,
any,
but
any
he's, yeah, there, so he's experienced yeah, in that go. Game, but what do you call it? I know how to like battle people on that game.
I was actually gonna ask, because you brought that up, is there any other games that you're really good at? You won't think you're good at them, but if let me just rephrase it, or that other people would consider you being good at.
There was one game that I actually considered myself good. I was actually considered the best player there.
Oh shit! It was
a mobile game, but this is also a bragging right to you. It's not self-proclaimed, but it's called the Bleach Brave Souls. So, in the mobile game community, or like any mobile game community, have you heard the term called the whale?
Yeah, or just people that are like oilers, just spend money to like pay to win. Yeah.
In other games, it's called pay to play.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty much, one second. So pretty much, that game. There were a lot of if you were a pay to play player, or aka whale, you had a huge advantage, but. In that game, I was a free-to-play player. I didn't spend a single dime, yet I toppled over people who spend tens of thousands of accounts. Tens of thousands of dollars on their accounts.
Was it time-restricted? Like, is it just sheer amount of time you had to put in, or was there skill?
It was both.
Okay.
So they released this new game mode called Guild Quest. Then it had both... Because no one figured out the meta, but I was literally one of the first, actually, I was the first person who figured out the meta and how they're like, how to get like the best times and stuff. So when I didn't tell anyone, I was a bit of an elitist, but I wanted to use that as my advantage.
Mm-hmm.
Then, what do you call it? And they thought, and these guys thought I cheated too. Because, like, you know,
they thought you were a whale too, probably, right?
They also thought I was a whale as well. But later on, they found out I was a free to play player.
Holy.
They're like, what the hell? So, that's something I can confidently say. But RuneScape, no.
RuneScape is, there's such a huge variety of play styles. And, I mean, even something like, you know, hardcore mode exists, and I would say Mutz is the greatest like hardcore player, and that doesn't fully translate over to like the entire game. He's not like, you know, Wooks all of a sudden, but for that specific classification, I would say he's the best. And then there's also PvP and other arenas or areas of the game where I'd consider other people better, but
so PvP and PvM are two different communities.
Totally. Okay, here's a question from Snail.
Ooh.
Serious question. If Jagex contacted you to develop a challenge for Raids 4, what would you include?
A challenge for Raids 4?
Yep.
So something I talked about in the past where there needs to be more high-risk factors, high-risk, high-reward factors. So if you want to execute something in, like, the best possible way, you need, like, two... If there's a boss you want to fight, and if you want to throw out the best DPS possible, so, for example, Leviathan, if you want the best DPS possible, you don't stun it, because if you stun it and proc it special, you deal less damage. But if you want to deal the best possible damage, I think what they should add is, sure, you can do this other method for full DPS, but there is a huge drawback. So something like that onto Raids 4 would be really cool to see.
Hopefully it's not as crazy as no stun, awaken Leviathan. Jesus Christ.
Oh, definitely, because like, no stun? what do you call it? That was actually draining to do, because it is all based like on reaction, and like, yeah. I literally had to take 2 days to practice.
Yeah, that might be a little bit too much.
So something not as crazy as that, but yeah, something like close to that. So like you're forced to do like precise, like you're forced to follow a precise procedure to dish out like the best possible results. If you can't do that, then you can still damage the boss, but you just won't get like the full benefit.
Yeah.
So yes, a concept like that, I think, onto like a boss in Raids 4 should be there. It'd be really cool to see.
Now here's his joke question: do you enjoy single-handedly keeping the price of Awakener's orbs high?
Yes and no. Because one, these bosses are really fun. Really fun to play. But at the same time, I'm losing money.
Yep.
I don't like losing, like, sure, I have a lot of GP, but I don't like losing GP.
Yeah, losing 9 bill. That's probably not great.
I'm not even though I like have like a thorage collection. Not to brag or anything, but like even though I have that collection, I still like wanna have some GP. So just in case new gear comes out, I can buy it and use it. I know there's people that would buy new pieces of gear, and they would just hoard it for like no reason.
Just on the topic of Raids 4, his like previous question, what would you want to see from as a mega rare from Raids 4?
A mega rare? Oh, that's a hard one, because you have the trifecta super weapons.
Yep.
Tebow, Shadow, Scythe. It's a hard one, actually. I would say shield.
See, that's what I was thinking too. It's just hard in this game to meaningfully add something interesting in the shield slot. Because if it's a traditional shield, it's actually taking away skill by just having a shield that deflects damage, basically.
You know what? You know that idea that you came up with, the spec? So something spec related.
Mm-hmm.
And so something main hand spec related. Probably something like that.
So what do you mean? Expand on it.
So Shadow, Tivo, and Scythe are main weapons.
Oh, I see. So not a shield.
Not a shield, but another weapon.
Oh, that, but actually a spec weapon.
It's a spec weapon that you main hand, pretty much. So like you spam special attacks to do damage.
That's literally like the spec pot, basically, just straight up. You know what, though? I mean, real talk, just a more simplified version. I'm just thinking, like, that actually would be a great kind of weapon to bring out for a mega rare. It's like a mega rare spec thing that's actually just used for specking. So maybe it would have, like, 25% special. Maybe this item would be worth in the bills, you know, because it is a mega rare. And it's, like, Dragon Claws, you know, times 0.5 or something. Just some crazy shit that you want to use everywhere, but it's tough. I was thinking shield would be a good thing. I also think potentially, I mean, one of the most simple things you could do, well, I guess mega rare is a little bit different, but I was thinking as a raids reward, just add an additional ring slot. Like that alone is basically a mega rare. Make it so you can wear two rings, but they have to be different.
Yeah. That wouldn't be a bad idea either.
Okay. This questions coming from Oreo. Favorite activity outside of OSRS, aka what do you do when you feel burnout come on to help clear your mind?
One common thing I do is just be bored, really. So I don't go on my phone and browse on TikTok, browse on Insta, or like YouTube Shorts,
mm-hmm.
and such. I just like just sit there until I feel like doing something, or even like sometimes nap. So doing that, I find a better result if I want to do something, but I don't want to do it at the same time.
It's pretty rare to find somebody that doesn't. It's not completely addicted to YouTube Shorts and TikTok.
Interesting. Yeah, sometimes I do that, but like if there's really something I need to do, mm-hmm. and I really don't feel like doing it, I just sit there and I don't have any video stimulations or really play. I know it's a proper term for it, but. It's either I'd be bored, or if I have nothing in mind, I would try to, or to actually like watch stuff. So like, whenever I watch stuff, it's usually about like, it's usually about editing. So whenever I watch a video, I always go through like how they did this graphic, how did they choreograph this camera angle and stuff. I'd always want to try to figure out like how they edit the videos and stuff. So like nitpick through the videos.
Interesting.
And then, yeah. Another thing is, did I mention sleep already?
Yeah, naps.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm a napper. I'm on my nap arc right now. I've been on it since ever since I got COVID back in October. It's like I was just sleeping all day, and then that kind of just stayed with me. It's just been It's just been the worst weather ever out lately. It's just been super cold and wet. So it's nap season.
Another thing, And then another common one I do, just play another game.
Like what? Do you have a favorite outside of OSRS?
I play League.
Okay.
Maybe just for fun though. So League of Legends.
Yeah. Are you good?
No.
Really? That's actually like surprising. Have you ever considered streaming it or playing any other game on stream?
No, because I'm not that good at League either.
Hmm. Have you ever tried to play like Elden Ring or any Dark Souls games?
Elden Ring? Oh, yeah. I actually have never played those. I've only watched people play it. I've only watched my brother play Sekiro and Bloodborne.
Hmm. So I'm gonna say, I bet you'd be pretty damn good at it if you gave it some time. So
it looks fun.
Yeah,
but I was like, I'll play another time. Then I ended up never playing it.
Because you're just a guy that loves the challenge, and a lot of people can get easily burnt out from like Elden Ring or just any of those kind of games because it's just failing over and over basically until you master the boss. But yeah, I bet you would actually like just dominate at that if you gave it a little bit of time. So
I don't like say, oh, I hate this game, throw this controller and stuff.
Mm.
I just see it as like if people can like one and done this, and if people can get this through this proficiently, I could do it too, right? Anyone can really.
Just give it enough time.
Enough time and like a moment to like realize what you a moment to realize how you fucked up and stuff.
Yeah.
So like there's a term for that, I forgot what it's called. Self something, but yeah,
just like self-awareness of like realizing how you died. Yeah, I don't know the word you're thinking of, but
yeah, there's a word for it, but I just can't
think of it. Reflection? Self-reflection? I don't know.
Maybe?
Doesn't sound quite right, to be honest, but I don't know what word you're thinking.
Self-preservation? That might be the term.
Mm. Or
somewhere, like, you know what I mean.
Right? Yeah. We all know.
So yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think that would be pretty cool if you, I mean, it sounds like you have gotten good. I mean, at that mobile game, I forgot what it was called, but it sounds like you're just a gamer at heart. So who knows? Oh, by the way, this is another question. Have you ever played RS3?
RS3? Not really. I've only done it for like login stuff.
Mm.
Right, but what do you call it? Is it called Squeal Fortune?
Or yeah.
Treasure Hunter.
The dailies. Okay, if I didn't miss anything, I think I'll ask you now, Noobtype, for 3 shoutouts from the community.
3 shout? That's hard. there's a lot of people want to shout out. Sido, my best friend. Yeah, why is it only 3?
Okay, I'll extend it. You can if you have a few more, I'll allow it this time.
My best mate Pierce. He's also like he's helping me a lot with tech and like how I can like do this and stuff. I always try to like whatever idea he has in mind, I always try to like replicate. Then I listed in the results and stuff. Then Hira. Can I say this word? Can I say this word?
No, you can't. No, you can't. Well, that's because of YouTube.
I was gonna say this word because he's Australian.
We can all probably imagine what you're gonna say, but he's also one of my
best friends. He's
okay.
We taught a lot of people, and then we rated a lot, and we taught like a lot of people as well.
Mm-hmm.
And he was with me a lot of, what do you call it? He was, yeah. Him, me, and Sido taught a lot of people on how to do like raids 1 and 2. And then who else? My friend Draco. He also teaches a lot of people as well. And he helps me a lot with my edits as well. So I ask a bunch of people whenever I'm editing, what do you think of this and that? Then most of the time people actually give me like their criticism and their thoughts on it. And now I would actually consider their, I would actually consider their critiques. So, and Draco has been one of the few people that gives me a lot of critique. He's also made, do you know about the AFK audio method?
Yeah, that's the one where you just blood barrage it, right?
Yeah, he was the one who came up with that.
Damn.
And shout out to No Monkey as well. So during when pretty much no one knew me in the past, he oftentimes would shout me out. He'd be like, "Follow this man." Just whenever I like tuned in, he's like, "Follow this man right now." And my follower count would like bump up tremendously. I'm like, "What?" Then same with Bodhi as well. Dude, there's so many people that's helped me. Oh my god. yeah, but recently Bodhi has been during the 1000 invo, like he's been like super supportive of me as well. He's been shouting me out sometimes when I go live on stream nowadays. So the big shout out to him as well. Shout out to Saxapillar as well. So he's also provided me with some tech. Man, there's so many people. Then shout out to Kringas. He's also taught me a couple. He's also taught me a bunch of stuff, a bunch of like PvN fundamentals. He's not well known, but he's a really good friend of mine. I think that's it.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, no, yeah, sometimes
there's a lot of people.
Yeah, sometimes I limit it to 3 just because I don't want people to feel so overwhelmed, but those are some great shout outs. So Noobtype, for those still listening, down in the description I'll have Noobtype's YouTube, Twitch, and Twitter down in there. He's not active on Twitter, but he definitely does post his achievements on there, so you can keep up to date with you know, what his newest crazy feat is. So with the release of Colosseum, I can imagine there's going to be quite a few. We'll see. But Noobtype, thank you very much for your time today. I really appreciate it. This was fun. And
thank you for having me. Oh, yeah. Did I shout out port 2? Forgot.
Sorry?
Did I shout out port Kazar 2?
No, you didn't. Oh. Is that included now?
Yeah, he's included too.
Okay.
He's a homie.
Shout out port Kazar. I'll give him a shout out as well. He's a legend. Noobtype, thank you very much. Guys, if you want to support the cast, down in the description there's a Patreon link and a YouTube membership link where you can pledge just $2 to support the cast. And next next Friday, I believe, we're going to be having Josh Pillalt on the cast, the RS Felon. And then the week following we'll be having Afzal and Unpredictable on the cast at the same time, so I'm very, very excited for those,
both of them. I know. I recently met Absol.
He's a gamer.
A pretty cool guy. Yeah, he's a cool guy.
Yeah, he's really cool. So that'll be an exciting cast as well. So thank you guys for listening as always. Thank you again, Noobtype, and we'll catch you guys in the next one. Peace.